The football continues on Saturday. Football Saturday on the radio side, our TV and internet audience. We welcome you inside the broadcast here inside Trailblazers Stadium. Dixie State football is back. Carrick Segmiller, Drayson Ball, Andy Thompson, the three-man crew back at it. Yeah. Guys, last time we worked together, we called a win over the number 6 Colorado School of Mines, so we had to bring the crew back together because we've got another top 10 team in the house tonight for the 2019 season opener. Good evening, everybody, and welcome inside the broadcast booth at Trailblazer Stadium. I'm Carrick Segmiller, and Dixie State, like I just mentioned, has a tall task on its hands for this 2019 season opener, but they've known about it since the end of last year. This coaching staff is excited. They are ready to go to try to take on this top 10 team in CSU-Pueblo.
Yeah, there's been excitement throughout the summer ever since Coach Paul Peterson got assigned to take over the job, bringing his firework offense here to St. George, and they've got their challenge for him. Week one against Pueblo, one of the best defenses over the past 5, 6, 7 years in the RMAC, and it's going to be a huge challenge tonight for Dixie State.
Drayson, this Dixie State team went 7-4 last season, 7-3 in the RMAC. Certainly a springboard year into what they want to try to do this season. That they've been so close to 8, even 9 wins if the ball bounces your way a couple of different times, a couple plays go your way. Dixie State, an opportunity to try to make a statement tonight after a wonderful year last year. A win tonight would be huge to show the conference and the nation what this Dixie State team wants to do in its final year in the RMAC and in Division II.
Yes, had a record in wins last year, overall wins at 7-4, and then obviously won all of their home games last season, went 5-0 here in Trailblazers Stadium. A good springboard year. You know, obviously we've talked about it. This is last season in Division II in the Rocky Mountain Athletic Conference. It would be a good start to this season, this final season, to go out with a bang, bring in a top 10 team in CSU Pueblo, come out with a win. Let's see if they're able to do that tonight. CSU Pueblo, though, a very, very good team, won the RMAC 7 out of the last 8 seasons, so they are no underdog coming into today's game despite being on the road.
Interestingly enough, this is the third top 10 team Dixie State has faced in its last 7 outings overall. If you go back to last season in the early October tilt out at Grand Valley State in Michigan, number 2 in the country, and then you host number 6 Colorado School of Mines late November, and then now number 9 CSU Pueblo to start here in Trailblazer Stadium. Dixie State all-time, 2-15 all-time against AFCA top 25 ranked opponents, but those two wins have come in the last couple of years. A win in 2016 at number 23 Colorado Mesa, and a win over number 6 Colorado School of Mines. We've mentioned it already, Andy. This seems like, and we've talked about this, you and I, in the years that we've been on the air together. Yeah. You've been around Dixie State football a long time. Your brother Judd coached here, played here. So you've been around this program a long time yourself. And I'm sure for you, like me, it's been amazing to see the strides this team has made since those early Division II years.
Yeah, well, what Dixie State was able to do in the Coach McClure era was bring defense to the table. They were one of the best pass defense teams in the conference over the past couple years. Struggled a little bit with the run. But what he brought was the defense. I think what Coach Peterson's going to bring is that home run hitting offense. He's got a quarterback this year and a couple of them, but the one who's starting today with a major league arm, they're going to be looking to stretch the field vertically. It's exciting. Like you guys were saying, they go 5-0 last year at home. The home faithful was treated to great games last year, and I expect the same tonight.
Great crowd filling into Trailblazer Stadium tonight. We're just about a half hour from kickoff. If you're out and about in your car looking for something to do, you got to be here. It's going to be a great product on the field. Jimmy John's is sponsoring some red T-shirts. First 1,000 fans here get free red T-shirts. And I should mention all of those red T-shirts emblazoned with the number 3. Tonight honoring a fallen comrade, Abraham Reinhardt, who passed away tragically in March. Just as the spring football schedule was getting underway. And it's been a tumultuous year for this football program. I mean, you switch coaching staffs, and then the new coaching staff, I mean, that's your first week of practice, and that certainly was on their minds and heavy hearts through the spring. But now they're here. They're ready to play for Abraham, Drayson. family of Abraham is here tonight. They're going to be honoring him in a couple of different ways. You know the guys want to win this one tonight for Abe, not just tonight, but all season long. They're playing for number three.
Yeah, and what a guy to dedicate this first home game to is Abraham Reinhart, a great athlete, but an even better person, an even better human being. He's certainly been missed in the 4 or 5 months leading up to this game, and obviously the players know that. They're aware of him. They made him an honorary captain this season just to kind of further honor his legacy, you know, but we can't talk enough about how he was as a person, as a competitor on and off the field. Glad that the Trailblazers are acknowledging him as an honorary captain and a little honorary segment here to begin today's game, and hopefully they can come together. And, you know, this is one of those stories you hear a lot about, teams rallying around a tragedy or some sort of an event like this. Hopefully the Trailblazers can do that, not just tonight, but throughout the entire season.
Let's start to break this thing down. Dixie State, CSU Pueblo, we are just under a half hour away from football again for the 2019 season. I don't know about you guys, but I was sitting there watching college football on TV last week, wishing that I could have the headset on and ready to go today. This day could not get here soon enough, but let's start to break this down. Let's set this game up. We've talked about last year. We've kind of looked at the outlook for this year. New coaching staff, a lot of new athletes on the field, even new uniforms for Dixie State. Nice new uniforms. Different color face masks. I mean, there's a lot of new things this year. So let's break this matchup down. And the way you do that is you look back over the last 3 years, 4 years of this series. Let's take a look at the series history between these two teams. CSU Pueblo leading 3-0 in this series. And we've talked about this on the Trailblazer Weekly Show, Drayson, over the last month. This matchup, it's can be a little confusing because you could look at it and say, oh, 3-0, CSU Pueblo has owned the series, and you don't want to go stretch too far and it'll be all about moral victories and Andy, but you look at game one, November 5th, 2016, it's a 24-13 game. You had a fumble return for a touchdown right before halftime, which I still to this day, I was there, I was in Pueblo, the runner was down. And the play was allowed to continue, and that swung the game. And then you lose by 11 points, 24-13 in Pueblo. A year later, Blake Barney at quarterback, November 4th, 2017. It's a 31-10 loss. So you look at it and you say, oh, it's a blowout. But it's a 17-10 game late in the third quarter. The wheels fell off for Dixie State. They just offensively were not able to get anything going. And then last year, which I think is kind of the anomaly in the three games so far, a 56-14 win for CSU Pueblo. You didn't have Mike Sanders, your quarterback. Yeah. He had been hurt in fall camp. You didn't have Sage Luongo, and it was a tough place to play week one, and the wheels came off early. But overall, when I look at this series, Andy, I see a competitive series, even though Dixie State has not yet won a game.
Yeah, I think what's interesting about Colorado State Pueblo, like Drayson said, they've been dominant in the conference for so long. 7 out of 8 years they've had a share, at least, of the conference title. But they offensively, they've kind of changed their identity a little bit. They brought in new OC Mike McCarty last year to kind of say, look, we've dominated the conference, but we can't score in the playoffs. Let's pass the ball around a little bit. And it didn't go too well last year, mainly because they didn't need to throw it a lot because they just ran over everybody. But they were last in the RMAC throwing the ball. That's something they definitely want to improve this season, is in the throw game. And I think Dixie State has been competitive against good passing offenses, but it all comes down to, like in these other games you pointed out, stopping the run of Colorado State Pueblo, because if they're going for 7 yards a carry, you've got no chance.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, Andy. Let's look at the tail of the tape, the 2018 stats between these two teams. Dixie State averaging 31.1 points per game, CSU Pueblo 36.5 points per game. You go down there and you look at the total offense. Dixie State actually outgained because of those last few games where they just air attack, yeah, air raided everybody. 458 yards per game for Dixie State, 409 for CSU Pueblo. But look at the difference in CSU Pueblo. 250 on the ground, 159 through the air. That will be different this year. Drayson, we talked to Jim Brooks, CSU Pueblo radio announcer on the Trailblazer Weekly Show earlier this week, and he had a lot of great things to say about the receivers. We've heard Coach John Riston talk about how improved the receivers are this year. I think you're going to see a team tonight, Drayson, in CSU Pueblo that's not just going to look to ram it down your throat, but they can sling it around as well.
Yeah, they got a couple of good returners. We talked to Jim Brooks, like you mentioned. He mentioned three or four guys that has said looked really, really good in fall camp and practice leading up to today's game. Ammon Johnson, Nick Williams, Max Fine, the tight end, Preston Guerra, number five, Deontay Sykes. A lot of good guys on the perimeter, a lot of good tall, 6'4", 6'5", type guys that can beat you over the top and also in the short to mid-range game and as well. So we know that they're great defensively. We know that they got an all-star or an all-caliber running back in Austin Meachie in the backfield. But this year they might give you a different look with their wide receivers on the perimeter.
I think you could probably use the word all-star, too, if you want to. It's Austin Meachie, and it's funny. It's a guy that he's never really been the feature back. Yeah. But last year he ran for almost 175 yards against Dixie State on only 7 carries.
Yeah.
So that's one thing Dixie State can't do tonight. And I've talked to Andy, you know, big Loney Fangupo, the Dixie State defensive line coach,
yeah,
who's played in the league. He's played and coached at the highest levels. He knows defensive line play. And I said, hey, did you watch the film from last year against CSU-Pueblo? And he said, yes, I did. I said, what did you think about all those long runs? 6 or 7 yeah, touchdown runs, maybe not touchdown runs, but CSU-Pueblo had 6 scoring plays of 65 yards or more, and half of those were long scoring touchdown runs. It's not all about the run for CSU-Pueblo tonight. They can sling it, but you cannot give up those big long runs tonight, Andy.
Exactly, and they had Denard last year, who was one of the best in the whole conference running the ball, but this Austin Meachie kid, he's small. He was a wrestler in high school. He weaves in and out. He's got great lateral mobility, and I think he's going to be a big – I mean, he rushed for 6.9 yards a carry last year when he was kind of the running back by committee secondary back. He's going to be a big challenge. And one of the names that Drayson brought up, Deontay Sykes, this is a D1 Arizona State guy, bounced back to Mesa Community. Coach Riston's one of his best signings as a transfer to come in. He is a legit threat down the field. I don't know if they had a receiver like him last year.
We've talked about a lot over the last couple of weeks on our show, and I know I've heard you and Devin talking about it too. What's the equation for CSU-Pueblo's success? Because CSU-Pueblo did not have a football program from 1985 to 2007. Coach John Riston comes in, they go 4-6 in 2008 and 7-4 in 2009, and ever since then, it's onward and upward, Drayson. These guys have only lost like 5 games in the last 10 years. They won a national championship. They've been in the playoffs almost every single year. We asked Jim Brooks, the CSU-Pueblo radio announcer, the other day, what is the secret to their success? And we've been talking about it, and it was one of the first things he said was, Coach John Riston, and it's the defense.
Yeah, Coach John Riston has really developed an unbelievable defense. That's what his philosophy is stop the ball and then make you stop them on through the run game. Specifically last season, like we talked about, they had 2 great backs. This year is no different. Austin Meachie as well as Marcus Lindsay, who's going to be his quote-unquote backup. But, yeah, like you mentioned, it's the defense. That's really where they shine. They take the ball away. They don't give it back very often. If the Trailblazers are going to want to have a chance to win this game, they have to do a few things. They have to win the battle of the trenches, like you mentioned. They have to establish a good run game, and then they got to air it out as well. They got to be able to beat you both ways, not just on the ground, not just through the air. They have to be efficient in both the ground and the air game if they're going to want to have a chance to come out on top on this one.
You're listening to the Dixie State TDS pregame show on ESPN Radio 97.7 FM. Also, you're watching it. You see this great shot of Dixie State Trailblazers Stadium on CEC TV on the HD channel 108 on TDS, as well as the Dixie State Stretch Internet portal, portal.stretchinternet.dixie/Dixie State. And we are breaking things down. A little bit later in the pregame show, we're going to give you some Quality Inn keys to the game. You can go check them out in Washington. Great place to stay. And then we'll give you some Cafe Sabor starting lineups. We mentioned it earlier. If you're just joining us in the broadcast, come by the stadium. You can get a free red T-shirt. If you're one of the first 1,000 fans, they all have the number 3 on them as we honor Abraham Reinhart, former Dixie State linebacker, who passed away in March. And, Andy, you're not talking about just replacing a good guy. You're talking about and you know what? I'm going to backtrack because replace is absolutely the wrong word.
Yeah.
You don't replace an Abraham Reinhart. You don't. Great guy off the field and an amazing student athlete. And so you're not just looking to try to fill the shoes of a great person and a great student athlete, but he's your leading tackler on defense. He was the leading returner on this Dixie State defense, and now leaving even more of a gap on the field and on top of that hole in our hearts that we still feel.
Yeah, absolutely. And talking about the production that he brought to the field, those are numbers you can look at that are tangible and say, holy cow, we're missing something huge there on our defense. But you're also missing, you know, 4 of your top 5 tacklers coming back this year on defense. You still have some studs in Lilliard and Yarbrough, who always gets in the backfield and causes trouble for the quarterback. But you got a bunch of sophomores on this defense that are talented. We saw them in camp. A lot of the word out was, man, they're looking good at pass defense as per usual, and they're physical up front. I'm excited to see guys like Tyler Heaton, some locals, Dylan Hendrickson on that defensive line, wreaking some havoc in the box a little bit. But you're right, Carrick. I feel like the last couple years they had proven entities on defense, and this year there's not as many of those as far as individuals who have competed at this level, making tackles, making plays in the secondary. So a lot to be shown tonight for that defense.
I'd say, though, they've looked good, Drayson, through the fall camp, and it probably should be this way in a fall camp, because if your offense is dominating your defense in fall camp, when the defense knows what you're running, then you've got problems on the defensive side of the ball. That's not the case. That's not how it's been. I was wondering, because there were so many new faces on this defense going into camp, how would they look? They've looked fantastic, and it starts, Drayson, with guys like Anthony Yarbrough up front, the reigning RMAC Defensive Freshman of the Year. Dylan Hendrickson, the hometown hero from Pineview, has played himself into a starting role on that defensive line. And a lot of young guys in that secondary and at linebacker that look really good. Augustus Frazier back there, Darius Nash, Alex Lilliard's back, one of the premier bandit linebackers. He's listed as a linebacker, but he's a defensive back at heart because he plays safety as well. But Drayson, this defense has looked really good, and I think we're going to see good things from the defense.
Yeah, one guy you left out was Darren Jones, who's a returning yes. junior, who's tremendous last season as well. But, yeah, you've got a lot of different combinations between guys. You got a lot of cornerbacks who are good, speedy guys, good coverage guys. You got some guys on the defensive line, like Andy said, in Anthony Yarbrough, who can wreak havoc on the opposing players' backfield or opposing team's backfield. And then you got guys like you mentioned, Alex Lilliard, Malaki there at linebacker as well, who can not only play coverage but can also play the run game. And they're going to need to do both of those things tonight. Going back, just want to mention one more thing about Abraham Reinhardt. If we go back to last season, the last game on this field.
Last play he made
on this field was the interception that led directly to that game-winning touchdown. Hopefully that legacy of Abraham Reinhardt lives on in some form or another tonight.
Man, I will never forget that play, yeah. You guys, because and maybe I shouldn't admit this on the air, but the play before when the field goal missed, I had my head buried in my hands, and I was a fan at that point, and I was heartbroken thinking that this Dixie State team had fought so hard to win this game, and maybe they weren't going to have a chance now, and then Abraham makes that play, and then Mike Sanders to Xavier Smith on the very next play to seal the deal. What a fantastic game that was. You are listening to the TDS pregame show here at Trailblazer Stadium on the Trailblazer Football Network. You looking for faster internet speeds? TDS has speeds up to 600 megabits per second in St. George. TDS is your local video, phone, and internet provider and a proud sponsor of Trailblazer Football. We got to take a break. We're going to take a two-minute timeout, but the TDS pregame show marches on as we inch closer to kickoff. We're going to tell you who to watch for. We're going to tell you, we talked about CSU-Pueblo's equation for success. We're going to try to tell you how you break that equation. How does Dixie State match that? Who to watch for? We'll give you some keys to the game brought to you by Quality Inn. And then, Drayson, we can revisit our Go Big or Go Home segment from Trailblazer Weekly, which Andy is essentially was a bold prediction segment.
Yeah.
Go Big or Go Home. What's going to happen tonight for Dixie State to be able to win this football game? That's all coming up next on the TDS cable pregame show, two-minute timeout, and back on Trailblazer Football Network.
There is a place where looking out means looking in, where an impression lasting only a few seconds will be imprinted on a life forever, where courage is forged and innocence rediscovered, where remembering is rewarding and forgetting unforgettable. There is a place where truth is felt and where seeing is believing.
Roger that.
There
thank you.
There is a place.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West, set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet. There is a place where the sun doesn't hide in the winter, where the greens stay green and the crimson canyons still glow. There is a place where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where we drive for show, putt for dough, and settle the score with another round. There is a place.
Your Dixie State Trailblazers taking the field inside Trailblazers Stadium as we inch closer to kickoff. Football is back, and we welcome you back inside the Dixie State broadcast booth here at Trailblazers Stadium and inside the TBS cable pregame show. Carrick Sagmiller, Andy Thompson, Drayson Ball along for the ride tonight. Last time, you guys, we've said it once, we're going to bring it up again. Last time we were all together for a top 10 matchup, Dixie State came out victorious, and we hope for that again tonight. It's time for us to tell the listeners what has to happen in order for that result to occur here inside Trailblazer Stadium tonight. We talked about the equation for Pueblo success. So, Drayson, let's start with you. And we're not quite to our quality in keys to the game yet, but let's start talking about and dissect this. How does Dixie State kind of come in and mess up that equation for success and try to spin their own equation for success?
Well, like I mentioned a little bit earlier, they have to be able to dominate both aspects of the offensive game, not only through the air, but also on the ground as well. We talked about a few times on our Trailblazer Weekly show, the only two losses for Pueblo last season was when they allowed more than 150 rush yards against for opponents. That's one of the key things that you talked about. I think it's important as well. But not only that, they have to, and this is maybe one of the things that I think is more important than anything else, is they have to stay in this game. I talked about it earlier. If they were to have a chance to win this game, you can't let it get two touchdowns, three touchdowns early in the first half. If you stay close with them and give yourself a chance to win down, win late in the game and not shoot yourself in the foot and make early mistakes, you're going to have a chance to win just based on the fact that you're going to be home. And if you can stay close, that gives you a good opportunity.
Andy, this football team is really good. Yeah. CSU Pueblo is really good. That's Captain Obvious statement for you there.
Yeah.
What do you do? Put your coaching hat on. What do you do to try to get your guys ready for this game and make sure that you feel confident and that you know that, hey, we're a great football team too. We can come out. We're not scared of these guys. We're going to win this football game.
You know, they've got – Dixie State has a experienced offensive line but still a young offensive line with sophomores. They got a true freshman starting tonight at left guard. The battle in the trenches, that's going to – like Drayson said, that's huge, and they've got to at least have a stalemate. But I also think to supplement the run game, they've got to be good on their five-yard routes. They got to hit the bubble. They've got to find the tight end on an RPO in the seam. We know Cody Wilstick can throw it deep. He can throw the home run ball. But it's so hard to run against this team. You can't have your bubble screens going for 1 yard. You've got to get 4 and 5 yards and trust your receivers to block on the edges just as much as you trust your offensive linemen to block in the trenches.
Andy, you've been in this local sports scene for a long time. You bring up Cody Wilstead. You've got your ear to the ground. You know what they're talking about right now. But one of the things that Cody was talking about after practice one day was the fact that you know, in high school, there was only one group of fans going for him. That was the Pineview fans.
Yeah.
And now he said he actually feels like he has a lot of, you know, people from Dixie High School or Snow Canyon or whoever it may be that are actually stopping him and saying, hey, I hope you win the job. Hey, I hope you do well. What have you heard around town in this local sports scene about Cody Wilstead?
Oh,
being a name and starter.
Completely agree with you about that, that he's a Region 9 star, a legend here. Coach Hosner, you know, Circle Blacks for Life over there for the Panthers. And everybody in the community is cheering for him. It was fun when Blake Barney was the starting quarterback for a while, going back to Skylar Entz and guys like that. Anytime there's a local, that's a big deal for Dixie State. And like we said, we know his talent. BYU was at Coffeyville, didn't get a lot of reps. I think he's ready to burst out on the scene for Dixie State this year.
Certainly hope so. Now let's go, Drayson, to our quality in keys to the game. We've already been kind of dancing around these things and talking about some things that Dixie State needs to do. You mentioned this one earlier, Drayson. You have to win the battle in the trenches. That means Dixie State, number one, has to establish the run game offensively, and number two, has to limit the run game offensively, has to put pressure on Gunnar Lamphere, this quarterback who has not taken a snap for CSU Pueblo before. You got to make him uncomfortable in the backfield. If CSU Pueblo is going to try to sling it a little bit more, you got to make him uncomfortable. You got to win that battle in the trenches.
Yeah, it starts with the Dixie State offensive line. One guy you got to key on is Jackson Wibbles. He comes back after last season. He's one of their best players on the defensive line. He led the team, or his third in team in tackles last season with 78. He was ninth in all of NCAA Division II with tackles for loss. He is the guy you got to really key on if you're the Dixie State offense. And then defensively for the Trailblazers, you got to be able to get to the quarterback. Like you mentioned, Gunnar Lamphere, first start as a college quarterback. If you can get to him and put some pressure on him, that'll just aid you, because we know about the run game. We know you have to stop the run game. But if you can take away their passing game and then you can really focus in on the run game, that's got to be the biggest key up the middle for Dixie State.
Next key, sound execution. Andy, we talked about how long you and I have both been around Dixie State football and how many games you've seen, how many games we've called together, yeah. How many games you've watched your brother play in or coach that – A snap goes over the punter's head, leads to a touchdown, a pick six, a fumble, whatever it may be. Seems like in these big games, there's always something. Dixie State found a way around those things against Colorado School of Mines is last November, but they've got to execute. I sound like Bronco Mendenhall, I know, when I talk about execution. Yeah. And that's, you know, people don't like that, but you got to execute. You've got to keep do your assignments. And you got to be smart and turn the ball over.
I agree with you, and I think year by year they've gotten better with those little things. One of the issues that plagued them over the last couple years, I think especially in game one, was the late flags, right? They're so amped up on the sideline. They're hitting people late or whatever. You want to see that, especially as a defensive coach, but you got to be disciplined. And that was one of the things that came out of camp about the defense especially, was how disciplined these guys look. Yep. And that's going to be a huge key in the execution tonight for the Trailblazers.
And there certainly were some times that were chippy, but that's expected in fall camp. You know, the guys getting each other. Our last key, quality in key to the game tonight, make big plays. You talk about not giving up the big play. That was the theme of the game last year when these two teams met in Pueblo, Colorado. Five scoring plays of 65 yards or more for CSU Pueblo last year. Cannot allow that to happen tonight, and you got to take it a step further. You have to make the big play tonight. Those are your quality in keys to the game, and it is time for us to take another 2-minute timeout for our national anthem, and they'll also have some ceremonies down on the field for fallen comrade Abraham Reinhardt. 2-minute timeout and back with the starting lineups.
Take the road less traveled, run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine, pouring on me. Think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day, because the sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
There is a place where rocks bleed and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy. Where dimples determine destiny and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents and opponents are friends. Where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
Where do you find the titans of classical music in St. George? Classical music on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM. Where do you find the legends of jazz?
on Radio St. George 100.3 FM.
Welcome back inside Trailblazers Stadium. A beautiful rendition of the national anthem during the break. And now honoring Abraham Reinhart, who former linebacker who passed away unexpectedly in March, just the week of the first fall practice. His parents are here, some family members here, and getting a standing ovation from this crowd, which a very, very good crowd here inside Trailblazers Stadium, guys. Of the crowd we had before the Fort Lewis game last night. Hopefully Dixie State can put on a show for the hometown crowd. We've given you the quality in keys to the game. We've given you CSU-Pueblo's equation for success, how to break that. Let's talk about who to watch for. Andy, we've mentioned a couple of names. Who to watch for on CSU-Pueblo and maybe even a couple of guys on Dixie State.
Yeah, I think one of the key guys on this defense for CSU-Pueblo, as always, is their nose guard this year. It's a fairly new guy, Trey Botts. He got some time last year. He's going to be the biggest guy in the field most of the time. But a key is getting his shoulders to turn a little bit and allowing the guards, Haunga and Tima, for Dixie State to get up into the linebackers. That's the biggest challenge against this Colorado State Pueblo team, is these linebackers are so active. They usually send five on almost every pass play. It's very confusing. But in the run game, if you can get up second level right away, keep your guards active and getting up to those linebackers, that's going to be a huge key. And I think those two guards, young guys, are going to play a pivotal role today in the run game.
Dixie State, CSU Pueblo getting set to do battle. When you're honoring, such a good guy like Abraham Reinhart, you almost feel bad talking about a football game here. But there is a football game to be played, and I think that's exactly what Abraham would be wanting us to talk about right now. He'd be the first one to want to get out on that field and to be able to try to win this football game. The team captains are heading out on to the field right now, and those were named earlier in the week. Nathan Aceves, Alex Lilliard, Anthony Yarbrough, C.J. Luongo, DeJuan Dantzler, and then, of course, the honorary captain, Drayson Abraham Reinhart. I just thought that was an amazing thing for those teammates to do for Abraham.
Yeah, they've made it known this season that they are they're playing 4A. They're playing this entire season in the memory of Abraham Reinhart, their fallen comrade. And, it's just a great thing to do. And, they got those stickers on the back of their helmet, as you can see there, AB3. Spells out Abe if you're looking at the three as a backwards E. But, just a tremendous player, tremendous competitor. Like you mentioned, he would want us to continue to do this this season and focus on that. And if he couldn't be out there himself, this is what he would want.
150th season of college football tonight. And that sound that you're kind of clipping it out is that microphone, ref. Hopefully we don't have any issues. So I believe he said CSU Pueblo has won the toss and elected to defer. So Dixie State will receive, and hopefully we can get some of those issues worked out with that mic ref so that you can hear our referee make those calls all night long. The coin toss is in the books. The keys to the game in the books. The TDS pregame show in the books. Guys, it's time to play football. The final seconds run off of the clock. 15 minutes up on the clock. Guys, real quick, in 30 seconds, final thoughts from each of you.
Well, I'm excited to see this first possession. You script out usually your first 15 plays going into a game. They've ran this series probably 100 times by now, and I'm looking forward to seeing how fast they come out and what tempo they show here in their first series.
We've heard all offseason about Paul Peterson and the offensive guru that he is. Led the nation in offense both his seasons at Snow College. He led them to a winning record both seasons and a bowl game win as well. We're going to get a chance to see it right off the bat here. First possession, Trailblazers are going to have the ball on offense, and we'll get the Paul Peterson offensive era underway.
Mitchell Carter going to get set to put this one into play. The TDS pregame show in the books. Let's play some football. Drayson, who we got back deep to receive for the Trailblazers as Mitch Carter gets set to put it into play.
We got Darren Jones as well as Darman Notoa. Darman Notoa on the near side of the field. Darren Jones on the far side of the field towards the top of your screen if you're watching with us on the internet or TDS Cable Channel 108.
Of course, Darman Notoa got a brother on the team as well, Ma'a Notoa, and they are both bruisers. So if you're watching on the TV, you've got Jones on the far side, Notoa on the near side. Ball is in the air. Let's play football, and it'll be fielded by Jones, 2 yards deep, angling to the left at the hashes. He has room to run. He's at the 20 and brought down just across the 20 to the 23-yard line, make it the 21-yard line, and that is where Dixie State will take over.
Yeah, Jones caught that one, had to backpedal a little bit, came up to about the 5-yard line, had to backpedal 2 or 3 yards, got into about 2 yards deep into the end zone, brought it out to the left hash. And as we get into the starting lineups for by brought to you by Cafe Sabor, we'll see them on your screen.
Let's take a look at the Dixie State offensive line. Who is up front for Dixie State as we start this football game? And from left to right, it is Alvarez. Aceves is the center. Give us the rest of those names as we get set here.
See, Tommy Haunga, left guard. Nathan Aceves, like you mentioned, at center. Right guard, Time Malitalua, and Adib Jowney on the right side.
Pass across the middle on first down. Wilstead looking for Ricky Johnson, the freshman receiver, electric receiver, and kind of thrown into double coverage a little bit, Andy, but Johnson was the only guy really who had a shot at that.
Yeah, I love seeing that. Just a deep post, first play of the game to a freshman. It's very rare at the D2 level that a true freshman can come in and start right away, but he's got a lot of talent on that right edge.
Dixie State going to go hard and going to go fast. Right back at it. Wilstead claps the hands off to Sage Luongo around the right end. He's met at the 20, stiff arm and lowering the shoulder, banging his way out to the 25-yard line. A pickup of 4 on second down and 10. It'll be third down and 6 for Dixie State to try to move the chains.
Yeah, this one looked like initially it was just going to go off tackle just a little bit. Sage Luongo had to continue to bounce this outside. Stiff-armed one guy to pick up a couple extra yards. Gained about three total yards on the play. It'll set up 3rd and 7.
3 receivers set for Dixie State on 3rd down and 7, they say officially. 3 receivers split out to the left, 1 to the near side. Wilstead has time, will step up in the pocket, runs into the back of his own guy, and now he'll be brought down. Gets across the 25, reaching for the 27-yard line. He'll pick up 3 yards, but he'll end up 4 yards short on 3rd down. Dixie State will punt it away.
And the pocket collapses on him quick. Here they send too many guys to block, 5, and he's got no shot. He's just got to put his head down, protect the ball, and go down.
Kyle Rosenbrock first there on the scene to bring him down just across that line of scrimmage.
Dixie State getting set to put this one back into play. Hunter Wood, the Dixie State punter, listed on the 2-deep.
Keaton Mott
is punting. I saw him punt. That's the backup quarterback. I saw Keaton punting in practice. He's going to come in and get the first punt of the season. Back deep to receive it at the 30-yard line is number 2, Amu Acustino. And he'll bring it across the 35, and that is where he is brought down. That's where CSU-Pueblo will take over.
Pretty good coverage there by Connor McKay, redshirt freshman linebacker for the Trailblazers.
CSU-Pueblo across the 35 out to the 37-yard line. So already having a couple different things thrown at you. Talked to the coaches this morning and said, hey, were there any changes on that 2-deep? And they said, nope, it's exactly where that's at. But Keaton Mott is going to come out in the backup quarterback. Played last year at the Division I level, Northern Colorado, played a lot of games, 6 or 7 games at quarterback. Did great, was a wonderful battle throughout fall. Camp Wilstead winning that battle. But he's going to come out, and he's going to take the Taysom Hill approach and do whatever he can to help his football team.
Could be something we might see a little bit later in the game, bringing your quarterback out as a punter might be used as a decoy, maybe for a fake punt possibly as well. So,
first down.
CSU-Pueblo takes the, and we've been waiting for this one, CSU-Pueblo lines up and takes the delay of game penalty as Dixie State lined up with just 10 players, leaving Abraham Reinhart's spot open. And now Dixie State declines that penalty, and we're going to play football. Lamphere has 4 receivers set, split out, 2 receivers split out to either side. 13:20 to go in the first quarter. Lamphere fires to the far side, caught and then dropped. Is that a catch and a fumble? It is not an incomplete pass, and a big hit on the far side on the receiver, Jensen Feggins, and he is down on the far sideline.
Yeah, just a simple out route, a little 5-yard out. Gunnar Lampier, the quarterback, as soon as he hit his back foot, threw it wide to Jeggins. Had it initially, but dropped it. He's still down there on the far sideline.
And Loco, too, he came up with a huge hit. I thought he led with his shoulder. I thought it was a clean hit, but definitely rung the bell of the receiver.
Still having some issues with that ref mic there. They're going to try to get that situated. But as you see on your screen, scoreboard brought to you by Camping World. We are scoreless, 13-16 to go here in the first. Second down and 10 for the Thunderwolves at their own 38-yard line. Lamphere with Michi at his right hip in the shotgun. Three receiver set, two split out to the right, one split out to the right, to the left. Will be one-on-one with Devin Chandler, the Dixie State defensive back. Lamphere calls for a man to come in motion. It's going to be read option run. Lamphere will keep it. Dives ahead for a gain of 3 yards. It'll be second down and 7 for the Thunderwolves.
I think one of the reasons why Lamphere won that job, I think Coach McCarty thought he was a little bit of a runner, and the system they're trying to convert to super spread, a lot of zone reads and stuff like that. Lamphere shows off a little bit of his running legs on that short game.
Third down and 7, or they're going to say third down and 8 officially. Big opportunity for Dixie State to try to get this ball back. Lamphere swings it to the right side. Pass is complete. Gets a block, but he stopped short of the marker. Needed 8 yards. Picked up about 6. It's going to be fourth down. Maybe not quite a full 2, but a long 1. Decision time for CSU-Pueblo. Try to go or punt it away.
And a great job closing there by Alex Lilliard. Sykes is probably their best athlete on offense. They're going to try to get him the ball in space. But great closing speed by a 3 trailblazers on that one, started by Lilliard.
Xavier Smith will come out to receive this punt.
Justin Dwinnell will get set to put this one back into play, standing at his own 35-yard line. Angling toward the left side. Fair catch called for and made at the 15-yard line. Dixie State will take back over. Two possessions, 2 3 and outs. Guys, what have we seen through the first 2 possessions of this football game?
Nothing super surprising. First couple of possessions of the season, first one for each team. A little bit rusty maybe, just kind of maybe knocking off a little bit of the nerves, getting used to the system, getting into a rhythm, if you will. A couple of punts, 3 and outs, if you will. Let's see if they can continue to capitalize here on this second possession.
I'd like to see Wilstead get just an easy throw, a short pass, just a complete one this series.
Pocket collapsed on him last time on third down, and able to get out of it in order to avoid the sack, but we'll see what they do here.
Wilstead will leave it with Alongo. Has room across the middle, across the 20, down to the 25-yard line, and that will be just enough for a first down. The first Dixie State first down of the season. Needed 10, got 10, C.J. Luongo, and now they hustle right back up to the line.
Jamal Sears on the tackle.
Wilstead right back to C.J. up the middle, and he's met and driven back by 3 CSU Pueblo defenders, but first he'll get 3 yards, second down at 7.
And Rosenbrock, the linebacker, one of their best returners from last year, came up and stuck him after just a couple yards.
Jackson Wibbles got the push initially off the left end. That's what had to force Luongo up the middle into Rosenbrock.
3 receivers for Wilstead, 2 out to his left. He's looking left, wings it to the left, and the catch is made by Jalen Powell. There he is. Jalen Powell, his first Dixie State catch, and Wilstead, his first Dixie State completion, and positive yardage for Dixie State. It'll be third down and 1 after the pickup of 6.
Exactly what Annie said, just to get Wilstead in rhythm. A little 5-yard out for Jalen Powell. He grabs this one, third and 1.
Hand off to C.J. Luongo, feeling his way forward. Does he have the first down? He does. The referee going to mark him right at the stick. Now he's going to move back a little bit. And I don't think he got it. It's going to be no gain. Boy, he marked him. When he ran in there the first time, he was across the 35 to the 36-yard line, and then they moved him back.
And so tough on third and short to run. I mean, Colorado State Pueblo was safety blitzing all of their linebackers. Every gap was plugged, and no shot for Luongo.
10:30 remaining here in the first. Fourth down and 1. They're going to punt it. Keaton Mott set to put this one back into play. Tevin Donnell. He's going to let that ball bounce in front of him. It's going to take a Dixie State bounce and roll inside the 20 down to the 19-yard line. Keaton Mott, great punt. Will set Dixie State up great defensively. 3 possessions, 3 punts so far. Flag on the play, sitting about the 40-yard line of CSU Pueblo.
Going to be a personal foul going against CSU Pueblo, maybe a block in the back potentially. It'll make a great punt even better for the Trailblazers.
Still having some issues with that ref, Mike, both not just us, but in-house here in Trailblazer Stadium. And We'll see if we can continue to get that for you. But 10-11 to go here in the first.
It's first game for everybody, right? Mm-hmm.
First game for everybody. On a beautiful night. The sun has gone behind the press box now. The bleachers on this west side of the stadium, and it can finally start to cool off a little bit. It was 101 degrees at kickoff. Not exactly your ideal football weather, but we deal with it here in St. George. Gunnar Lamphere and CSU Pueblo back out onto the field, starting at their own five. Jet sweep around the left end. Looked like he might be stopped short, but he'll cut it back inside across the 10 down to the 12-yard line. A pickup of five on first and 10.
Yeah, this is what they like to run. They like to run a lot of jet sweeps, a lot of zone reads off to that the sidelines. They want to get you out spread wide and see if they can't get in open space. They do here, but the Trailblazers are sniffing out pretty well, only give up 5 yards.
Good job by Lil. You're turning him back in, the spill linebacker, just a little bit late, and a decent gain there on first down.
Clock rolling, 9:40 to go in the first, no score. All punts so far. Dixie State owns the game's only first down. It was a 10-yard run by C.J. Luonga. Lamphere taking his time. Play clock at 4. At 3, claps his hands on 2. Hands off in the backfield. Starts right, cuts back to the left, and he's brought down by Devin Chandler after a pickup of 3 yards. It's going to be 3rd down and 2. Was able to get away from one tackler, but Devin Chandler, the defensive back on the near side, stayed home, was able to make that tackle.
DJ Pennick on the run, a little kind of almost a Statue of Liberty play, faked going right, came back to the left. Not sure if that was the design or if that was just where the defense forced him, but a good cover for the Trailblazers.
And good job penetrating there by Dylan Hendrickson. Didn't make the tackle, but kind of disrupted it just enough to make it a limited game.
Pennick remains your back on 3rd down and 3. Trips to the right side. Shotgun formation for Lamphere. Fires across the middle. Pass is complete. 4 first down yardage across the 20 to the 21-yard line. Call it a gain of 6 to move the chains for CSU Pueblo. And the Thunderwolves have their first down of the night.
Simple route by Ammon Johnson. Just got over the middle just where Gunnar Lamphere could see him. Enough for the first down.
So both teams have moved the chains once now. Man in motion for CSU Pueblo is Isaiah Diggs. They go back the other way. And the Thunderwolves going to get around the 30 down near the 31-yard line, and that's Ammon Johnson on the carry.
Trailblazers have had a couple opportunities after showing the reverse here. Tariq Wright had a chance to get him in the backfield a couple plays ago. They had a chance to make a tackle for loss, but just out of reach.
Okay, you got to wrap up these Thunderwolves. They're very crafty when they get into space.
Lamphere slings it out to the right side.
Wow.
And the ball is caught and fumbled. Dixie State going to pick it up. Here comes Nash. 10-5 end zone. Referee saying no.
Wow.
The ball was down.
What a play by Lilliard to blow up his block into the receiver, create the fumble. We'll see here on the replay if we agree or not with the call. But
Lilliard, you see him gauge with his blocker, comes off the block.
Oh, that's
there.
A fumble.
Yeah, that looked out to me.
That's 100% a fumble. Too bad you don't have review in Division II, because that's a touchdown for Darius Nash. 7:20 to go here in the first. We are scoreless, and now off free play. Now it's going to be the encroachment variety. Going to be 5 yards against Dixie State. It'll be 2nd down and 1 now. And that's too bad. Every once in a while, you have those plays that, you know, depending on how it's called, it can really swing a game. We mentioned in the pregame show, CSU Pueblo had a fumble that they returned for a touchdown in 2016. It was close just like that. The call was made that it was a live fumble. It went against Dixie State, and the Thunderwolves returned it for a touchdown, and that's what swung that game. Dixie State not getting that benefit of the doubt here. 2nd down and 1. Lamphere. Going to go play action. We'll dump it out of the backfield to Pinnock. He makes the catch and lowers the head across the 40 to the 42-yard line. 1st and 10 for the Thunderwolves.
Yeah, like I said, this is what they like to do. They like to get the ball on the sidelines, whether that's a jet sweep or a bubble screen or here it's just a little dump out into the flat to Pinnock. You see Lamphere rolls the pocket, dumps it there to Pinnock. He's able to get around and find his way. He knows exactly where the sticks are, picks up the first down.
6:44 on your Camping World scoreboard. We are scoreless midway through the first quarter. Lamphere, delayed handoff to Pinnock. Starts in the middle, cuts it back to the right. And then finds the center of the field again. He'll pick up 3 yards. Second down at 7. Coming up for CSU Pueblo.
They've done great against the run so far tonight, has Dixie State. Their gap discipline's been awesome between the tackles. And that's a huge key tonight, as we discussed, is not allowing Colorado State Pueblo to be averaging 7 yards a carry.
Tariq Wright and Sear Barnes, in on the tackle.
Back judge just ran up and tugged Devin Chandler's jersey down. It's NCAA rule the last couple of years. You have to have the jersey all the way down. Lamphere will swing it to the far side. Catch is made again by Ammon Johnson. He's busy. On this drive, he holds on to it this time. It'll pick up a couple of yards. Third down upcoming. Third down and 1.
And if it ain't broke, don't fix it. Another bubble screen out to the right. You know, these passes don't travel far downfield, if at all. They're more almost lateral passes, maybe just 2 or 3 yards downfield, but they get out wide and are based on timing, quickness, and just getting out there, getting 5 or 6 yards.
Third down and 1, across the 50 to the Dixie State 49-yard line. Pressure comes, and Michi loses the football. They're going to call it an incomplete pass. He never had the football. Lamphere felt the pressure, tried to dump it to Austin Michi out of the backfield, and Michi never had control of the football. Otherwise, it might have gone forward for a first down.
Yeah, constantly never had juggling control. And it bounces off of his knee. Wow.
Yeah, just juggling it there. Never had a secure possession. It'll force fourth down and 1. Looks like the Thunderwolves are going to punt it.
Thunderwolves will put it back into play as Dustin Dwinnell gets set to punt this one away from his own 40. High punt. Fair catch called for by Xavier Smith. He makes the catch inside the 10. Back to the 8-yard line, make it the 9-yard line, and that is where Dixie State will take over. This year, the RMAC Conference following the media format. So we have a media timeout at the 5:16 mark of the first quarter. We'll take a 90-second timeout, come right back. We are scoreless, 90 seconds, and right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
There is a place where young and old make connections, where kids feel like grown-ups, and grown-ups feel like kids. There is a place where beauty arises in contrast, where wonder is universal, and laughter second nature. There is a place where friends find a future, families find each other, and feelings find their home. There is a place.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West, set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
There is a place where the desert comes alive, where rain breaks forth from solid stone and gardens spring from blistered rock. There is a place with enough color to make a rainbow jealous, where boulders are bigger than buildings and cliffs are higher than clouds. There is a place that will straighten your step, tighten your grip, widen your eyes, and open your jaw. There is a place.
Welcome back inside Trailblazer Stadium. The first ever media timeout in any of our broadcasts here in football. Dixie State with possession. Play action. Wilstead going to roll out to his right and throws it to Jalen Powell. Connor Miller thought that might be to him, and it sailed over his head. Jalen Powell makes the catch about 7 yards downfield. It'll be second down and 3.
I thought Wilstead did a good job of throwing him open there. I think if he threw to the depth where the receiver was, it may have been incomplete. Threw it shallow, threw him to the sideline. Great job.
Second down and 3. Ball at the 16-yard line. Wilstead claps his hands. Read option, keeps it across the 20, and then gets out of bounds after picking up the first down to the 24-yard line. Caught a pickup of 8 yards, and Dixie State moves the chains.
Yeah, faked it to Andrew Canelli-Robles, the back in the backfield, pulled it out and was able to have a lot of room to run over there on that right sideline. Gets around the corner, picks up the first down.
Dixie State loaded at running back this year. If it's not Luongo, it's Andrew Canelli-Robles, like you said. It's the Natoa brothers. They are loaded at running back.
They didn't have a lineman out to break the huddle.
They didn't have a center.
Yeah, their center.
Nathan Aceves, not sure if he was off the field, but Joshua Partida, number 72, came in late. Wasn't even in the huddle on that play. Trailblazers forced to call a timeout to avoid a penalty.
I don't know where he went, but Wilstead was yelling to the sideline, "We were missing a guy. Let's get a fifth lineman out here."
It's the first game for everybody, and you better believe Wilstead's not going to let that play.
You see, Wilstead taking some snaps right now from Partida. I wonder if Aceves may have just gotten a little shaken up on that play, but looks like going forward, at least for the time being, it will be Joshua Partida at center for the Dixie State.
Trying to find that near sideline here and scan the sideline and find big number 73. They're working on 58, Taylor Alvarez, as well. That's one position that you just, at this Division II level, you can't afford to go down at, especially this early in the season, is your offensive line. But
suppose it's possible Nathan Aceves, a really good utility guy, could have moved over to left tackle.
He could have played everywhere.
If Taylor Alvarez is indeed off on the bench, which we see he
yes.
is getting worked on a little bit, it's possible.
And maybe that's where he was.
Some of that communication, maybe Alvarez moved to left tackle. Joshua Partida now in at center.
We're going to keep it right here through the timeouts. They're brought to you by Dairy Queen. Makes me want to go get a Blizzard. Cookie jar Blizzard.
Gotta go with
it's not on the menu, though. It's one of those hidden ones that you got to ask for.
Oh, really? Secret menu.
Cookie jar Blizzard all day long and all night long. Timeouts brought to you by Dairy Queen. 4:44 to go here in the first quarter. We're scoreless. First down and 10 for Dixie State from its own 24-yard line. Wilstead on first down, play action, has time, loads up, home run ball downfield, has Dantzler, and he can't make the catch. In fact, it's picked off at the 30-yard line by Emery Taylor, the stud senior defensive back for the Thunderwolves, and he'll make a diving interception at the 30-yard line.
Yeah, this one was thrown basically into double coverage. Emery Taylor was back, had good coverage on Dantzler all the way throughout. His route ball was maybe just a little bit underthrown. Emery Taylor's not going to miss that one very often.
Love the chance, love the throw. Like you said, great coverage by the Thunderwolves. Maybe just a little bit more on it would have avoided the pick, but a really athletic play there by Taylor.
And a good job by Amu Acastanio
to kind of shield off.
Came back yeah. over from the safety position as well to support Emery Taylor.
Well, like you guys mentioned, if Dantzler doesn't have to slow up, he might catch that and still be running. Lamphere on first down. He'll load up. They want to take a chance. Has a man there, and it is caught. What a catch inside the 20 to the 19-yard line by Deontay Sykes. You talk about back-to-back amazing catches, one by the defensive back, one by the receiver. Lamphere to Sykes. What a play for CSU-Pueblo.
And JT Anderson was beat from the get-go on that route. I think Wisely tried to pass interfere. But still, great catch in traffic
and the
on this one.
The 6'3 receiver just has the edge there over the smaller cornerback. Great play from Sykes. That's Pueblo up inside the 20.
We talked about CSU Pueblo, and they're not just a running team this year. They can air it out and throw it. You saw it there. CSU Pueblo into the red zone for the first time tonight, right at the 20-yard line. Now confusion on their side of the ball, and Coach Riston going to take a timeout. Both teams taking a timeout on their last drive, and Coach Lamphere, or not Coach Lamphere, Coach Riston calling
coach
the timeout,
the field, though,
and Gunnar Lamphere coming over to the coaches, expressing his frustration, kind of pointing things out. Guys, it's the first game of the year. There's going to be some hiccups like that, but boy, CSU Pueblo, an interception, and then you take a home run ball. You like when it's your team that's going for those shots. You like to see them trying to take those shots down the field, and it worked for CSU Pueblo.
We've seen a lot of home runs in the past years running the ball from Colorado State Pueblo, but just that play in the early down just to launch it to a guy like Sykes, who is so talented. We see him in the screen game, the tunnel screen catching balls, yards after catching, stuff like that, but he's got vertical ability. That was made clear on that last play.
And that goes back to what we talked about on the pregame show, the execution on back-to-back plays, home run balls by either team. One defense executed, the other one did not. That's how fragile the momentum in this game is and how quickly it can change one side to the other.
3:55 to go on your Camping World scoreboard. Again, timeouts brought to you by Dairy Queen. And CSU Pueblo right on the door of the True by Hilton red zone. Lamphere, read option, going to keep it. Tries to spin out of a tackle, but the tackler says, uh-uh, that's Sir Barnes, the freshman, making the tackle. And he brings Lamphere down after a four-yard pickup.
It's one thing you have to do. You have to always keep an eye on the quarterback because as they do like to run those jet sweeps, that's just to set up that quarterback keeper there. He's able to pick up 3 yards, but a good open field tackle by Sir Barnes.
We mentioned it in the pregame show. Brought to you by TDS. Lots of new faces on this Dixie State defense. But lots of talent. Young but talented. Second and seven from the 16-yard line. Lamphere with a single receiver to either side. He's going to leave it with Michi. No, he's still got it. What a fake. Here's Lamphere, 10, 5, and brought down at the 4-yard line. What a fake by Gunnar Lamphere. Everybody in the world thought that Michi had the football, and Lamphere spins away.
Wow.
And that's Lindsay.
My, oh, my. And it wasn't Michi. You're right. That was Marcus Lindsay.
And that's one of those plays where I think Gunner maybe initially wanted to give it to Lindsay and then saw the defense crashing, pulled it at the very last second.
Lamphere up under center. And this is classic, as Jim Brooks, CSU-Pueblo play-by-play announcer, told us as Dixie State takes a timeout. We'll keep it right here and talk through this one. But, you know, Jim Brooks, the CSU-Pueblo play-by-play announcer, told us that, you know, the first 6-7 years of Coach Risson's tenure, it was the power eye, which you saw him line up in just before the timeout. And, you know, you're seeing him, as you mentioned, with the new offensive coordinator last year, and Mike McCarty's here, and doing different things, you know, out between the 20s. But when they get inside close to that end zone, they're going to go back to their bread and butter. And they were lined up in the power eye. We'll see if they come back out in it.
You know, and I don't mind a couple plays ago on the jet sweep that Lamphere kept. They overcommitted on the jet sweep, and on that one they just tackled the running backs. I think that's okay because those are the guys that are going to kill you. Lamphere has made some really good decisions, but he's not going to bust it for a 40-yard gain or something like that. So just a great series by Lamphere. That last one, I thought he was committed to the handoff and then just yanked it out. Three trailblazers tacked on the running back. He goes for an easy first down.
And going back to the power eye, Lindsay lined up as the up back, Austin Michi as the tailback, so to speak, if we're going into the old terms here. That's a good combination, 1-2. You could give it to either one of those guys, to either side, right side or left side. You can even have them run off to the side there. A good combination if we're Pueblo with those two backs.
Back out of the timeout. Dixie State has spent two timeouts here in the first quarter. 2:41 to go in the first. Man in motion for Lamphere. He's under center. Rolling out to his right. Looking. Pressure comes. Has to get rid of it. He's driven to the ground by Alex Lilliard. And oh no. Lamphere. And now a flag going to fly. Gunnar Lamphere slow to get up. You never like to see anybody hurt. And the flag flew way late. There was no one even around Lamphere. No red jersey even in the area.
Well, the flag is thrown clear in the secondary, almost on the goal line.
And it's going to be a personal foul. The ref mic is not working, so we're not going to be able to hear what number it was.
It looks like it was a dead ball. Isn't it, when he raises his hand, a dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct?
Yeah, that's unsportsmanlike conduct. It's a personal foul after the play. We've talked about those.
Let's see if we see it here.
But Lilliard made the sack, and I don't know, maybe he said something after the play, or like you said, maybe it was – and you just you don't see anything there. That's unfortunate. So first and goal for CSU Pueblo. Lamphere will leave it with Pinnock. And he'll try to back his way into the end zone. He's not going to make it. No gain for Pinnock. It'll be second down and goal from the two.
And again, the runs between the tackles, there's a red wall there. We talked about the battle of the trenches and how hard that's to at least stymie and be a stalemate with Colorado State Pueblo. So far, pretty impressed with Dixie State's front seven.
Michi lined up directly behind Lamphere on this play.
They'll leave it with Pinnock. He tries to dive over the pile and get in there, and he stopped. No gain again. Third down and goal from the 2-yard line.
Gunnar Lamphere still working out that right arm. Not sure if maybe it was just a little stinger. That sometimes happens. You hit your elbow hard on the ground, you get a little stinger, a little numbness down below your elbow.
Well, he reacted immediately to the hit. You thought, oh no, it looks like he might be hurt and have to come off, but he's fighting through it.
Still shaking that right arm.
Huge play here. Two receivers to the left. Third down and goal from the one. Can Dixie State complete the goal line stand? Lamphere keeps it, and he's stopped. Lamphere keeps it on the read option, and he is stopped by Connor McKay, the redshirt freshman linebacker from Stansbury, Utah.
And he had a lot of momentum going right towards the goal line. McKay got low and pulled him backwards. That seated row in the gym has really worked out for McKay on that play, because
yes,
he had a ton of momentum and he was just stopped and pulled all the way back.
Dixie State says, I see the flag after the play and I'm going to raise you a goal line stand. And it's Mitchell on for the chip shot field goal, and it is up and through. He's automatic, especially from right there. CSU Pueblo strikes first, but it's only a field goal. Dixie State, the goal line stand. CSU Pueblo 3, Dixie State nothing on your Camping World scoreboard. We take the 60-second timeout. Come right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
Run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine. Pouring on me, think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me.
Where do you find the titans of classical music in St. George? Classical music on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM. Where do you find the legends of jazz? Evenings on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM.
And out of the timeout, DeJuan Dantzler fields the kickoff 5 yards deep in the end zone, and he'll take a knee. Touchback. Dixie State will take it out to the 25-yard line. And for CSU Pueblo, it's an 8-play drive, 69 yards, including the 50-yard bomb downfield. But Dixie State, they didn't escape unscathed, but the defensive line held up, the goal line stand, and you force them to a field goal.
Amazing. I mean, Colorado State Pueblo realizes now they're in a fist fight. They were stopped 3 times on the 2 and then 1 yard line. And Dixie State stood strong. Incredible stop at the goal line. And, you know, Colorado State kicking a field goal from that part of the field is incredible. A huge win for the Trailblazers.
And after the interception, Keaton Mott is now your Dixie State quarterback. Read option. It's a fumble. And Dixie State has got it. Are they pointing to the ground saying that the ground forced the fumble? Casey Allison dove onto the football, so Dixie State had it anyways, but Kennelly Robles had that ball squirt out, and the Trailblazers will maintain possession. Keaton Mott, the redshirt junior out of South Jordan, Utah, he'll keep it on second down, and he'll pick up 5 yards on the play, and it'll be third down and 4 upcoming for the Trailblazers, as that was probably the last play of the first quarter. 4-3-2-1, that will do it. 15 minutes of football in the books, guys, and Dixie State trailing 3-0.
I think Dixie State's got to be thrilled with their defensive effort against the run by everybody except the quarterback. None of the running backs were able to get much ground, and then that defensive stop, that's huge confidence for this defense.
Yeah, we haven't really talked about any of the running backs other than Penick, who we didn't really mention that much, a good quality guy, but nothing from Meachie, really, nothing from Lindsay, really. It's really been the jet sweeps. Ammon Johnson's had a good first quarter, but obviously a good start for the Trailblazers, just giving 3 points, especially when you had them first and goal at the 3-yard line.
We'll keep it right here through the quarter break. Just had a break right before that. And the Dixie State trailing 3-0. Let's take a look at your team stats after one quarter of play. Dixie State with just 2 first downs. CSU Pueblo, especially on that last drive, they end up with 6 first downs. We take a look at trying to find the total yards there. Where it is, Andy? Why can't I see the total yards there? Trying to give you the stats here, and I don't know how to read my own own statue. There he goes, right there. They got Andy Thompson, the stat guru, that's able to point these things out for me. CSU Pueblo, 115 yards in the first quarter on 19 plays. Dixie State, 46 yards on 12 plays. But they took some risks. They opened things up. They tossed it downfield. And ended up in the interception, but now Keaton Mott out onto the field.
Yeah, and I think, you know, we already see him getting a zone read opportunity between the tackles. That's one of the things that he does better than Willstead is with his legs. So it'll be interesting to see now on third down if they opt for a zone read or allow him to throw it for the first down.
15 minutes up on the second quarter clock. Jason, you're quiet over there right now. What are you thinking about?
Yeah, just, you know, excited to see Keaton Mott, what he can do. We talked about the quarterback battle between him and Willstead early in the season. Both of them offer a couple different things, like Andy mentioned. Keaton Mott a little bit more with the legs on the zone read. Empty set here for Keaton.
Five receivers set on third down and four. Mott with time. Throws across the middle, and he threw behind Jalen Powell, and it'll be incomplete. And Dixie State will have to punt it away, and Mott just scoots back. He says, I'm staying in this football game. I got to do the punting honors now.
Yeah, short little play. It was just one of those plays to get Jalen Powell right at the sticks. The first down marker was at the 35. It was just simple up and in route over the middle. Mott just threw it right behind him.
Do you fake it on fourth and four from your own 31?
I'd say maybe save that one a little later.
Back deep to receive for CSU Pueblo is Amu Acostino. Mott going to get this one away, a high end over end kick. And it will be fielded, fair catch called at the 37-yard line. And that's where CSU Pueblo will take over.
See if the Trailblazers defense is able to come back out and have the same intensity, the same energy that they had just coming off that big big goal line stand from the 3-yard line. Excuse me. See if they can continue to do that. Maybe force a 3-and-out, get your offense right back onto the field.
14:50 up on the second quarter clock. Dixie State trailing 3-0. Most of these matchups against CSU Pueblo have been close, you know, 1-2-score games into the third, even into the fourth quarter. Just a 3-0 game now. And I believe that's a different quarterback. Drayson, see if you can get a number on that thing. You got the binoculars.
Indeed it is. It's Jordan
Jet
Kitna.
Sweep around the left end. Kitna coming in to hand that ball off. And the sweep around the left end by Nick Williams will pick up 7 yards, second down and 3.
Yeah, Kitten, a 6'2 sophomore out of Dallas, Texas. Another good quality quarterback. We didn't know really who it would be between him and Lampier to get the starting job to come into the season. Kitten, though, very capable of playing well at the position.
Well, Kitten, it's in his blood. He's got that Kitten last name. That quarterback blood running through those veins. So Kitna in the backfield with Marcus Lindsay at his right hip. We'll throw to the sideline. Incomplete. Good coverage by Darren Jones. Pass intended for Nick Williams.
Yeah, Darren Jones, a little 10-yard out route by Nick Williams. Darren Jones played good coverage on this one. This one was a little bit overthrown over the head of Nick Williams. But Darren Jones there putting pressure.
Clock stopped 14:06 here in the second. Third down and 3. On the Thunderwolf 46-yard line, can the Dixie State defense do it again? Keep its team in it until the offense can get humming. Kitna drops back. Pressure comes. Gets through the first layer of defenders, and then it is brought down across the 49 to the 50-yard line, and there's a Trailblazer injured on the play, and I think that's Alex Lilliard.
Yeah, Lilliard
threw his
helmet off immediately, sitting right at the 50-yard line. He was the one in on the stop there initially. Brought down Kitna right there at midfield. And he clearly right now is in a lot of pain.
And he has been everywhere so far through a quarter and change here for the Trailblazers on defense.
Coach Peterson going to come out to check on his guy.
Rolled up, sitting now.
You just hate down to see that. I mean, to anybody, but especially someone who's worked so hard, had such a good attitude through the coaching staff change and accepted Coach Peterson and the new staff and had a great trip with Alex out to the RMAC kickoff in late July. And we'll take another look, see if we can see possibly what could have happened. And see him come in to try to make that hit. And just
almost looks like it could have been a friendly fire situation where another Trailblazer came in and hit him a little bit up high.
Well, let's all the replays and camera angles you see brought to our great CEC TV crew.
Alex is up, walking under his own power. Now he's going to jog off, and he's got his helmet in his hand. That's good to see. Trailblazer Nason exhales collectively. It looks like he's going to be okay, and hopefully we can see number five get back out there. Such a key part of this defense. And like I said, someone that he's a four-year guy. He's a senior. He's worked hard. He's helped build this program to where it is now and is part of this Dixie State football legacy.
Yeah, not only that, as a good player, he's a leader as well. The team looks to him both defensively and off the field as well.
First down and 10 at midfield. Kitna loads up, pass across the middle, and a diving catch is made. He was wide open. Pass was just ahead of him, but the receiver had to dive and make the catch, and Ammon Johnson is up to the task, and it's a first down for CSU Pueblo. Well, I'm telling you, and Jim Brooks told us this, the CSU Pueblo announcer, he said, everyone's expecting CSU Pueblo to run. They're going to open up, and they're going to throw the ball around.
Yeah, that's Darius Nash that was back there. Let Ammon Johnson get the inside seam on him. A little bit of a fake to the outside, came back to the inside. Nash not able to undercut the receiver there.
13:25 to go in the second and ticking. First and 10 from the Dixie State 20. Kitna, bootleg out to the left. Fires back across the middle. Pass is complete. And a first down. Down to the 6-yard line. Is that's the big
tight end. Preston Guerra.
Preston Guerra.
Kitna's looking great. Watch this fake he carries out. Very professional. Great footwork. Rolls out. Tight end just has a few feet on the defensive player. Right to the hands of the sticks.
And
great throw.
And he does a good job of getting his feet turned around to square to the target. A lot of times you'll see quarterbacks throw on the run with their shoulders towards the sidelines. He does a good job of turning that up the field.
First and goal from the 6. Kitna to the end zone. Incomplete. Devin Chandler there to break that one up. Pass intended for Deontay Sykes. It was one of those bang-bang plays. Sykes is probably thinking that, hey, I think he got there a little early. Chandler says, right on time.
Trailblazers in another situation where first and goal from the 6-yard line. Can they make another defensive stop right here near the end zone and force another field goal attempt?
Clock stopped at 12:51, second and goal from the 6. This is a huge second down play here. Kitna will leave it with the running back, and he's in. First CSU Pueblo touchdown of the season.
That's Marcus Lindsay, just gets the dive up the middle. This is one of the things that Pueblo has been known for, is just running it between the tackles. They say, we're going to run it between the tackles and make you stop us. Marcus Lindsay, if that name sounds familiar, it's because he's the younger brother of Denver Broncos running back Philip Lindsay. So he's got that football blood in him as well.
And I thought the linebackers were a little bit on their heels, expecting maybe a throw in that situation, and they were just blown up off the ball for an easy touchdown.
Mitchell Carter on to attempt the PAT. Kick is up and is through. 10-0 CSU Pueblo with 12:47 to go in the second. Plenty of football to be played. Dixie State has got to do something offensively to try to stay in this football game. We take the 60-second timeout. Come right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
There is a place where looking out means looking in, where an impression lasting only a few seconds will be imprinted on a life forever, where courage is forged and innocence rediscovered, where remembering is rewarding and forgetting unforgettable. There is a place where truth is felt, and where seeing is believing. There is a place.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that.
on St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this.
Hello, my track quit.
Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
Welcome back. Dixie State fans trying to urge on their guys, trailing 10 to nothing. Carter set to put this one back into play. Going to be short and returnable, field at about the 5-yard line is Darren Jones. At the numbers, room to run, 30. Breaks a tackle, 40. On his feet to the 50 and tripped up beyond the 50 to the 45-yard line of CSU Pueblo. Darren Jones, Dixie State needed some sparks, and there's some fireworks there.
And a touchdown saving tackle by Max Gonzalez there on the return team on the kicking team for Pueblo. If he doesn't make that tackle, it's possible Darren Jones gets onto the sidelines and he's gone.
Just what the doctor ordered for Dixie State starting this drive in CSU Pueblo territory.
Mott getting his second series. I don't think him being put in had anything to do necessarily with Wilstead's interception. I wouldn't have Wilstead for that throw, but I think this was scheduled, yeah.
Darman Natoa will get his first carry as a Trailblazer. He'll dive forward for 2 yards. Second down and 8 upcoming, and you're certainly right about that. Could be a scripted, you know, every couple of drives type of thing. Coach Peterson told us that, you know, Wilstead was named the starter, but you're going to see both quarterbacks. Mott on second down, miscommunication with Natoa. Was expecting him to go right or left. He stretched the ball left, and Natoa was going right. So Mott had to just keep it. He picks up 1 yard. It'll be third down and 7.
So far, Trailblazers haven't really been able to get a good drive going. Had a few plays and a first down on the last couple of possessions, but really since then, nothing either through the air nor through the ground.
On third down, Mott. Pass inside, intended for Jalen Powell. Got his hands on it. He couldn't haul it in. It falls incomplete there in coverage with Anthony Barron, the junior defensive back.
And I think he's got to throw that just a hair earlier. He's been wide on his last couple throws on that slant route, but a pretty well-run route. Good design. He had the space, but just couldn't make the completion.
Dixie State going to punt it away. This Trailblazer offense has had some trouble moving the ball. And they'll get set to punt it away. Mott standing just across midfield. And he puts a foot into this one. It'll take a bounce at the 5. Will it stay out? Can Dixie State keep it out? They do.
No,
they're going to say touchback. What an effort by Connor Miller to try to keep that one out of the end zone. Or was that Braxton Hatch? That's
Connor Miller. You had it right, Connor Miller.
Connor Miller.
Yeah, Connor Miller thought he got this one at the goal line. See if we can see it here on replay. It takes a bounce there about the 3-yard line. Takes a right turn.
It might have hit the line.
That one might have hit the line. Or he might have his foot on there as he touched it. But very, very close. Of course, the referee's right there looking down the goal line for that specific play.
We'll talk to the good folks at CEC and see if we can have the pylon cams
inserted for the next
home game. And then, you know. As if they don't already do enough for us. Here we are begging for more.
There's a good down the sideline or down the line cam.
On first down, here's Kitna. He's going to air it out and has a man. And he'll make the catch at the 30, on his feet to the 20, tackled from behind at the 10-yard line. And that's Sykes.
And that's the second time on first down. He's just 5 yards ahead of the defensive back in one-on-one coverage. No safety to be seen. And another strike thrown by Kitna, and Sykes is just showing his next-level ability here tonight.
Yeah, Devin Chandler, it's going to be tough to keep up with him all night. Sykes, a great speed receiver on the outside, and Devin Chandler just not able to keep up with him as they complete this long pass. Sets themselves up inside the 10.
First down and 10. Make it a first and goal from the 10. We heard about these Thunderwolf receivers and these quarterbacks all through fall camp, and we're seeing it here. End around on first and goal from the 10. Legs churning. It's Michi. Gets down to the 6. And a flag will fly. And in that location, you're thinking probably a hold. Clock stopped at 10:58 here in the second while they work out the penalty. Indeed, it will be holding. That'll move back and be first and goal from the 20.
Head referee Cecil Harrison. Not able to get that mic straightened out. It's always nice to have the mic working, but of course, like we've said, it's first game for everybody.
.10:58 to play here in quarter number two. Dixie State trailing 10-0 and trying to keep CSU Pueblo out of the end zone another time. Here's Kitna. Fumble the football. It's loose. Who's got it? Dixie State pointing their way. CSU Pueblo pointing the other way. Kitna, and they're going to say CSU Pueblo football. Looked boy, like Kitna was carrying the ball out in front of him with one hand.
That's surprising to me because the big lineman was the first one down, but then he kind of went sideways, and there were two trailblazers landing right on top of where the ball was.
I think it might have been Anthony Yarbrough to force this fumble.
Sir Barnes has the football.
I thought they called that too early.
Yarbrough forces it.
There's a lot of red right on that ball. I don't know how that got torn away. He must have given it to the lineman right away. It was lying sideways.
Second down and 18. Kitna, broken play, loads up to the end zone, has Sykes, overthrows him, incomplete. If you're CSU Pueblo, how many times can you dodge a turnover? That's twice.
Yeah, absolutely. And Dixie State, just their front four, is putting a tremendous amount of pressure on Kitna. Now third and a long goal to go.
Yeah, right now it's really been, like you said, Andy, the defensive line. The run game has basically been non-existent. It's been through the air where the Trailblazers have gotten burned so far. If they can get more pressure on the quarterback, that could turn the tables for them immediately.
Third down and goal from the 18.
And Loco Tui's got to be rolling over to Sykes' side, and it looks like he is.
Pressure comes to Michi out of the backfield. Makes one man miss, still on his feet.
Peace.
And that's Austin Michi. Low to the ground, hard to tackle. A couple different Dixie State players, I don't know if they're shaken up or just ticked off at themselves for not making the tackle. Loku Tui and then Malaki Malaki. Well, Malaki Malaki kind of came in friendly fire, took out Loku Tui.
Yeah, like you said, that's what Austin Michi does. He's such a good back. When he gets out in open space, he can make you miss. He's not only, you know, he's a small guy, but he can really lower the boom.
And I didn't see a flag, but now they're marching off a personal foul.
I didn't see what happened.
I didn't
the flag
see what
was
happened.
Well,
it
know,
was
way,
way
back.
Back. They're going to say roughing the passer. I'd love to take another look at that. And I hate to say this, but I think Dixie State just has a reputation inside the RMAC. Refs are looking for after the whistle plays. Kitna is going to run it in, and he's into the end zone. No, he stopped on the one. Down on the one. It'll be... This is the run. I'd love to go back and look at the roughing, the passer penalty if we could. Not like I could change anything now. 9-12 to play.
You see Kitten's,
second and goal from the one.
Kitten's knee was down there. The ball not quite crossed the plane of the goal line.
Man, devastating call on a third down.
It's at Dixie State, can't catch a break. Second and goal from the one. Michi stopped short. Third and goal from the one.
Here we are back again, the same situation we were two drives ago.
A personal foul, and here we're gonna get our first look again at the roughing the passer penalty.
Yeah, that's rough.
That's roughing. Yep. That's fair. And on third down and goal, they're gonna uncover the pile. Where's the runner? No signal yet. Touchdown. CSU Pueblo in. It's Kitna, quarterback keeper.
And, man, Kitna has come in since the injury to Gunnar Lamphere a couple of possessions ago. It led him to back-to-back drives for touchdowns. You see here, just a quarterback keeper. He's able to get a little catches Dixie State a little bit off guard maybe and just goes right into the end zone. You see there he gets across the line. Back-to-back possessions lead to a touchdown for Pueblo.
Pueblo's showing the helter-skelter not the official term for it, but different. And Dixie State did that in 2016. They'd line up kind of looking like they were going to fake it. Now the PAT will be kicked up and in. 17-0, CSU Pueblo leading it on your Camping World scoreboard. And we have a media timeout here in the second quarter. Take the 90-second break and come right back to Trailblazers Stadium.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the Trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West, set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
There is a place where the sun doesn't hide in the winter, where the greens stay green and the crimson canyons still glow. There is a place where dimples determine destiny and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where we drive for show, putt for dough, and settle the score with another round. There is a place.
I take the road less traveled, run free, unwind, unravel, someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine, pouring on me, think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun is gonna shine on me, sun is gonna shine on me, sun is gonna shine on me.
Welcome back to Dixie State University, Sark Arslanian Field, inside Trailblazer Stadium. Good old Sark, Dixie State football legend.
And not a bad seat in the house there. You come sit on the grandstands or sit out there on the field if you wish.
DeJuan Dantzler going to field this one at the 2. Dantzler across the 20, brought down at the 23-yard line. Make it the 21, and that is where Dixie State we'll take over. 8:18 to go in the second, and guys, been tough going for this Dixie State offense at this point. What are you looking for on this drive to try to get something going?
I think trick play.
Well, yeah, I mean, you got to. Yeah, I agree with you.
I agree with you. And they've tried to throw it deep early in you know the series, and it hasn't worked out. Wilstead's back in the game, and they're going to come out with a trips bunch left, and we'll see if they decide to throw it first down.
So they are going every two series. Wilstead back into the game. Three receivers to the near side. One is DeJuan Dantzler split out wide to the right. Pressure comes. Wilstead slips through it. He's on his feet to the 20 and is crunched at the 25-yard line. Was on the run, so he couldn't. He was leaning forward, couldn't really slide, and had to just take that one. And he's back up and back to get this next play going.
Yeah, good pickup on first down. You see there. Does a good job of stepping up in the pocket and avoiding the pressure you see here coming from the left end. That's just a corner blitz there, avoids two tacklers.
It's A.J. Luongo on second down, tries to get around the left end, and he'll pick up a yard. Third down and 5. Guys, it just seems like when you go fast, go hard, if you don't gain the yards you need, it's three and out pretty quick.
Yeah, exactly.
You're putting a tough task on your defense.
And I haven't heard a lot from C.J. Luongo or really any of the Dixie State backs at this point. Love to see a little more consistency going just overall offensively.
Wilstead on 3rd and 4. Across the middle, pass complete. Jalen Powell at the sticks, first down.
Maybe that's something that'll get him going, get a first down. We've seen that same play a couple times. Try to ran to Jalen Powell. The previous two possessions have ended up in an incomplete pass on this exact same play. This time they complete it. Hopefully that springboards them going forward.
A.J. Luongo at the left hip of Wilstead. Takes a snap. Luongo tripped up from behind. What a tackle. And that is Will Hefner, the senior linebacker. And he got in there and he grabbed the ankles of Luongo. And C.J. went down. But, of course, Hefner may be getting the worst of it. He had to go and sit down. Hope he's okay.
And maybe you know, first game of the season, maybe you're experiencing a little bit of cramps at this point. I mean, it's obviously a hot day down there, especially hotter on the field, and maybe seeing a little bit of that at this point in the game.
6:45 to go. Hefner is shaking up on the play. We're going to take a timeout. Dixie State trailing 17-0. Take a 30-second injury timeout. Come right back to Trailblazer Stadium.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that.
Nope, not that.
A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
.6:45 to play. Welcome back inside Trailblazer Stadium. Hefner is able to walk off the field under his own power. I hope he's okay. Hopefully he can return to this game. I don't care what color jersey you're wearing. We want to see you stay in this football game. We don't want anyone getting hurt. Wilstead on second down. Pass incomplete to Connor Miller. Kind of funky looking on the far side. Didn't look like he had it for a minute. And then squirted out of his hands, and it falls incomplete.
Yeah, throws it backwards, and they're getting up to line quick here for third down.
Third down and 9, in danger of having to punt this one away. Ton of time left until halftime also. Wilstead loads up, pass across the middle, intended for Allison, and threw it out in front of him. Had to get rid of it quickly because pressure was coming. Incomplete. Dixie State forced to punt again.
Yeah, this one, Casey Allison just coming over the middle, a little 10-yard post route. Tries to find the seam. This one just led him a little bit too far. Long reach by Allison. I would bring that one in with one hand.
Got to complete that pass. I mean, that was one of the most open opportunities on a third down for the Trailblazers tonight.
Keaton Mott set to punt from his own 20-yard line. They bring the house. And Mott gets off a dandy over-the-shoulder catch at the 15, and he's brought down immediately. Acostino thought that one was coming in short. Had to make an over-the-shoulder catch, and Keaton Mott gets that one up and away.
And Dylan Douglas was the man that made the open field tackle there. A good punt sent Acostino back and had to make, like you said, the over-the-shoulder catch. And by that time, Douglas was there to wrap him up. Good, a momentum changer if you're Dixie State. Hopefully you can get a good stop here, a 3-and-out. Set yourself up in good field position. Get your offense back out on the field.
And good for Dylan. The long snapper was talking to him about his journey just the other day about, you know, the frustrations of wanting to play other positions in high school and just not getting those chances. And so settling at long snapper just so that he could play. Doesn't get a lot of the glory, but he works hard and makes plays like that frequently. 6:19 to go in the second. Here's Kitna still in the game at quarterback, and he's brought down. The first Dixie State sack of the night, and Kitna loses 2.
And good pressure once again off that last edge, off that left edge. Yarborough in there, and they're hitting Kitna on the ball. He did a good job somehow holding on to that as he tried to tear it away as he was going down.
And that was Lillard who came on a blitz. The initial pressure was given by Yarborough, like Andy said, and that forced Kitna to step up. Alex Lillard doubled back and got him on the blitz.
5:45 to play. Dixie State trailing 17-0. Kitna. 3-yard pass to the sideline on the far side is complete. And it'll be third down and 7.
And with Kitna in the game, they've gone kind of away from the run, mm-hmm. and he's throwing it really well. But now Dixie State on a good position of the field defensively with a third 8 coming up.
Quick pass out to Max Fine, his first reception of the game.
With 5:15 to go until halftime, if you're Dixie State, if you can get a stop here, there's still time to make something happen before the break. Kitna rolling out to his right, will lob downfield, and it is caught at the 50-yard line. There's going to be a pass interference call on Alex Lillard, but the catch is still made by Isaiah Diggs. What a catch.
And he just runs a simple wheel route, gets out into the flat, and makes Lilliard commit to him, and then he turns it back up the field. That gives him the edge, the extra step on Alex Lilliard. Throw is thrown a little bit behind him. He comes around the defender as we see the pass interference call here by the referee. He's still able to come around Lilliard and make the catch as he's falling to the ground. Really a tremendous play.
And I have to keep harping on this. The talk of the town was how good the CSU Pueblo receivers are this year, and we are all believers.
I mean, Lilliard form tackles him before the ball even gets there. And
what a
one
catch.
On the catch.
And a good throw by Kitten, throwing that one off, but his back foot had enough juice to get it there.
5 minutes until the break. Pitch out to Pinnock around the left end. Still on his feet. Lowers the head and drives forward, surging for the first down. Picks up 10 yards. And now this Thunder Wolf offense starting to click on all cylinders. And we mentioned it when Dixie State had the ball a few minutes ago. The one downside to a go-hard, go-fast offense is if you're not successful, your defense pays the price.
And we see the old-school under-center student body left pitch, and it goes for a big game.
Kitna, play action. Pressure coming. He's hit as he throws, and it is incomplete. You're going to have a chop block. Is what my guess is. You saw the play action, and Pinnock, the running back, immediately dove down and speared at the feet of the Dixie State defensive lineman.
And the chop block, for those of you who don't know, is when a defensive player is already being engaged by a blocker, then a running back or some other player comes in and takes out his knees. That's considered a chop block. You can't do that when a blocker is already engaged. You see here, Pinnock comes across the formation off the play action. You see that's where he's engaged with number 70 there, and then he takes out his legs. That's a classic chop block. The back referee is going to get that every time.
E.J. Heckard into hit Kitna as he got that one away. It's going to be first down and a country mile. Here's Pinnock hurdling a man and then brought down by the next man. Aaron Simpson trying to make that initial tackle, and Pinnock goes up and over the top. Probably gets an extra maybe 2 yards out of the deal, showing his athleticism. Just the old school backyard pitch off again.
And good contain. I mean, they had lead blockers. They had a lot of momentum going to that right side, but Dixie State was up for the challenge.
Yeah, good tackle there as well by Brandon Reber.
And Mark Lopez in that number.
Mark Lopez, excuse me.
The number changes earlier today. Mark Lopez was slated to wear number 55. They just changed that number just today.
And, of course,
nothing like getting a call at 9:15 a.m. saying, hey, we need to change a number.
And of course, the SID in charge of changing the roster didn't do so.
Long pass downfield, and it is caught again inside the 10, down to the 5-yard line, and CSU Pueblo in business. Jason calling me out for not changing that number. Those rosters went to the printers on Tuesday, my friend.
Gotcha. As we see here, I mean, Jordan Kitna right now is just carving up the Trailblazers defense right here. You see this pass thrown perfectly to Nick Williams there on the sidelines. He catches it in stride, sets him up inside the 10-yard line, first and goal. I mean, Kitna's coming into the game after the injury to Lampier and really played well.
They'll pitch to Pinnock, right side, diving for the end zone. Ball is loose. They're going to say it was forced. The fumble was forced by contact with the ground. It'll be down at the 1-yard line. Second and goal at the 1. This offense firing on all cylinders.
I'm just so impressed with Kitna's ability on that last one. It was decent coverage. He's thrown easier passes than that down the field. They're just dropping from the clouds into the laps of these Thunder Wolves receivers.
.244 to go until halftime. Second down and goal from the 1. Pinnock is swallowed up, goes nowhere, loses yardage, back to the 5. It'll be third and goal from the 5. This Dixie State defense, you've got to give these front 5 guys a lot of credit tonight, because they've been put in a lot of tough situations, and they're doing everything they can to keep CSU Pueblo out of the end zone.
And we've called just about every one of their names. That one was Tyler Heaton, first in on the tackle. We've talked about Anthony Yarborough a bunch. Tariq Wright's been in on a lot of them. Dylan Henderson has forced a lot of plays as well.
Third down and 5. Kitna will lob to the end zone. Man is there, incomplete. Do they keep the flags in the pockets? They do.
Trying to
Aaron
get Sykes.
Simpson in coverage.
Trying to get Sykes on a jump ball. It was physical, but I thought it was clean. Good job is keeping the flags in the pockets, I think.
That Dylan Hendrickson that kind of stayed with. It was Hendrickson coming back to help on that. You see. See a big tall guy, 6'6", 6'7", back there. That's not a DB.
And Deontay Sykes runs 6'3". Aaron Simpson just 5'9". Not a bad play call when he got such a height advantage. Lob it up there to Sykes, see if he can make a play. This one thrown just a little bit too tall for him.
Mitchell Carter on to attempt. 22-yard field goal, right hash. Slightly high snap. The kick is up and good. He's automatic. 20-0. Dixie State trailing with 1:55 to go until halftime. And it could be worse if it wasn't for a pair of goal line stands by this Dixie State defensive line.
Could be a lot worse, could be a lot better for Dixie State. So many things did go their way that was on a razor's edge in that first half. But the good news is, like you said, Carrick, three possession game, you got a chance for a 2-minute drill right now to pull out all the stops. Try to cut it to a two-score game going into the locker room. Looking forward to seeing what they have planned here for Willsted with 4 or 5 wide on the series.
1:55 to go until the break. And CSU Pueblo a 20-0 lead. Dixie State offense has gone hard. They've gone fast. But they've not been able to move the football, and this Dixie State defense has been on the field forever.
And there's kind of been a lid on the offense so far. Nothing going for over 10 yards through the throw game. That needs to change quick.
Ball fielded by DeJuan Dantzler at the goal line. And he's chased out of bounds across the 20 to the 25-yard line on the near side. And Dixie State will take over at its own 25-yard line with 1:49 to go. You've got one timeout.
You love to see the offense here at Dixie State go and get some points. They're gonna the Pueblo's gonna receive the ball after the second half, after the halftime break. You can't go in here without points if you're Dixie State and then give them the football right back on the outside of the other side of the halftime break.
Willsted, still your quarterback. Dump it to the running back. It's Kennelly Robles out of the backfield, and he loses 3 yards on the play, second down and 13. That play snuffed out from the get-go.
And that's Kyle Rosenbrock, their leading tackler from last season. He sniffs that one out immediately. A good wrap up there while he waits for his teammates to come and gang tackle Canelli Robles.
One 12 to go and ticking until halftime. Willsted loads up. Complete to Jalen Powell, but just back to the original line of scrimmage. They'll pick up 3. It'll be 3rd down and 10. And whistles, and CSU Pueblo going to take a timeout.
Yeah, CSU
Are they trying to get the ball back?
Yeah, CSU Pueblo is going to hope their defense stops him here on 3rd and 11 and then see if they can get the ball back. They've got still one timeout remaining, if I'm correct in saying so.
Yeah, they'll have one more.
But, you know, at the rate that their offense has been moving the ball down the field, especially with some of those deep passes, they got to feel like they have a chance to get here, get another score here if they can get the ball back.
And I love that call by John Riston. You've got all the momentum, call the timeout. Dixie State's being super conservative, 2 passes that are basically runs with a chance to go down with a 2-minute drill, but they're just going to be content to hopefully waste some more clock and be interesting to see if they go for it something past the sticks here on 3rd down or if they're content to just run it.
Well, gamesmanship would say Dixie State on a 3rd and 11 would run this one and at least make them use that final timeout and then maybe punt it away, give it back to them with maybe 40, 45 seconds remaining and see, you know, if your defense can come out and make one more stop before the halftime break.
I say throw deep.
I don't think you can go into the locker room in the fetal position.
Yeah.
You've got to put the lid off somehow. You're down 20. I've been disappointed with the 2 play calls. You know, you had 1:55 to go down and try to do something.
1:02 to go until the break. 3rd down and 11. And this CSU Pueblo offense has been able to move the ball with the deep ball, kind of at will anyway. So full receiver set for Willstead. Takes the snap. Passing situation. Steps up. And is brought down. Pressure comes. Ball came out late. CSU Pueblo trying to argue for a fumble. They're going to say it's caused by the ground. It's going to go in as a sack.
Yeah, this was just good man coverage. You see man coverage lined up on the trips to the right side. Two safeties back in deep hashes. But really, this was a coverage sack. You're able to get good pressure off the end. That's number 42, James Maxey. And then, of course, brought down there by a couple of different Thunderwolves.
Cody Willstead had the ball after the loose ball anyway. 46.8 seconds to go. Pueblo does spend its final timeout. They're going to have the game clock be set back to 49 seconds. Well, guys, a team doesn't come into this game ranked ninth in the preseason poll in all of Division II just for nothing. Very good football team. Dixie State trailing by 20. And if it's not for the defensive line, it could be even worse. But they're going to have to go into the locker room and hope they can figure something out offensively to say, what wasn't working, what can we do to try to make some adjustments. We're going to get, a real quick look at Coach Peterson and his ability to go on the fly, to make adjustments at halftime, and try to come out with a little bit different plan in the second half.
And we'll see the numbers at halftime, but you come into this game, key number one, contain the run game of Colorado State Pueblo. They did that to perfection.
Yes.
They just got to figure out the long balls.
Eaton Mott will put a foot into it. Line driver fielded at the 50. Runner changes directions. He's free across the 45. And is tackled from behind by Braxton Hatch. Redshirt freshman out of El Paso, Texas.
Yeah, shoelace tackle there by Hatch. Able to bring down the returner. And if not for that one, he had at least 10 more yards in front of him. If not, even more if he makes another guy miss. But the Pueblo here set up in good position with a chance to punch this one in late in the second quarter.
Acazatino went left. Completely changed directions, and now he's got his team with 36 seconds to go. They're out of timeouts, but they're at the Dixie State 40, and you've seen Kitna's arm. I wouldn't be surprised to see him take a shot at the end zone right here. Kitna. Swings it out right, and incomplete pass, a near one-handed catch by Ammon Johnson. Falls incomplete, and now a Dixie State player is down hurt. And is that Lilliard. Alex Lilliard again?
Lilliard again. This one looks like he's in more pain as well. This one
might be a cramp.
Again, could
hopefully.
Be a cramp. They're stretching out that calf muscle. Again, like I said, it's hot down there. And when you're running up the field, especially when you're not used to conditioning, I played football in high school, but that there's a difference between practice conditioning and game conditioning. The game is just a different animal as far as the conditioning. This defense has been on the field a lot when it's 100 degrees down there, 95 degrees probably now that the sun has gone down. This is keen to happen, especially the first game of the season.
32.4 seconds remaining as they continue to work on Alex Lilliard just before the break, and it's the second time he's gone down tonight. We hope he is okay. Well, they're still working on him. Let's step away. Let's take a quick break. 30-second timeout and come right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
There is a place where rocks bleed and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy. Where dimples determine destiny and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents and opponents are friends. Where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
.4 seconds remaining in the second quarter, still working on Alex Lilliard. Trailblazers trailing 20-0, and we're talking during the break, Andy, that it's it's got to be frustrating. You know that CSU Pueblo is a very good running team. And you focus on the run, and you're saying during the break you're kind of beating them at their own game, and then all of a sudden, hey, CSU Pueblo can throw it now.
Yeah, exactly.
And what do you do? You know, it's a multifaceted football team that can beat you in a lot of different ways.
And I think Dixie State, when Kitten has been in there, they've had some success getting up in his grill and pressuring him a little bit. They've caught him off guard early in series, throwing it deep in that one third down. But in this situation, you can't just send four, I don't think. You've got to send more than they can block and not give them the time to have that receiver go deep, because Sykes has been one-on-one in most of those situations.
And then the other side of that coin is your corners have to play good coverage defense and be able to run with those receivers down the sidelines. If you're going to get pressure on the quarterback, you also got to be able to cover the receivers downfield.
32.4 seconds remaining. Second down and 10. You're just joining us. The first down play nearly saw Ammon Johnson, senior wide receiver from Denver, Colorado, reach up with a big hand and bring it in, Odell Beckham style. But it squirted out. Now second down and 10 from the 40. Read option. And Kitten is going to keep it.
Amazing.
And he goes nowhere.
Amazed by that
the
play
clock
call
will run.
Situation. Hendrickson with a big eat-up tackle there.
Loses 5 yards on the play.
Yeah, that's good discipline by Dylan Hendrickson not to go for the play fake, the read pass option there, faking it to Lindsey. He stays on Kitna, which is his assignment, and brings him down there. A big loss and takes a lot of time off this clock.
They've got no timeouts, and they're just going to
take
it
into the locker room.
What in the world?
With how they were throwing the ball through the entire first half, I'm stunned. I'm stunned by that. I thought they'd take a shot at the end zone.
Huge break for Dixie State.
Yeah, they'll take it. Dixie State trailing 20-0. Heading into the halftime break. Guys, 30 minutes of Trailblazer football here tonight, and a little bit different result than I think we thought we would see at the half. But a few things have held true. Dixie State defensive line and those linebackers playing very good, very talented, young, but playing very well and really limiting that run game. But it's been that wild card in that pass game that's been the problem for Dixie State.
Yeah, there's no separation for the receivers, whether it's Allison or Danzler out of the backfield even. Nobody's been open. When they have been, they've missed him in key situations. So for me, the focus is quarterback play and receivers. I don't know what you do, but you've got to figure out a way to get guys more open on offense.
And you've never really had a lot of consistency offensively. You picked up a first down here and there, but you've never really had a good sustained drive. I feel like if you could get two or three consecutive first downs on a drive and get maybe into a little bit of a rhythm, especially with a couple of brand-new quarterbacks taking their first collegiate snaps here, I think that would really help the Trailblazer offense. And if you could get three or four first downs, maybe you score, maybe you don't. But if not, at least you get your defense a little bit of time to get a breather on the sidelines.
Dixie State trailing 20-0 after the first 30 minutes of this football game. But this game far from over. Coach Peterson will go in, and they will make some adjustments, and they will make some things happen in the second half. We'll break it all down for you inside the Seven Oaks Jewelers halftime report. We're going to take a full 5-minute timeout. When we come back, we'll start to break it all down. We'll look at the numbers, and we'll let you know what Dixie State can try to do differently in the second half to have a different result. CSU Pueblo 20, Dixie State nothing. 5-minute timeout, and then back for the Seven Oaks Jewelers halftime report.
There is a place where looking out means looking in, where an impression lasting only a few seconds will be imprinted on a life forever, where courage is forged and innocence rediscovered, where remembering is rewarding and forgetting unforgettable. There is a place where truth is felt and where seeing is believing. There is a place.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that.
Nope, not that.
A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative,
Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this.
Hello, my track quit.
Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
There is a place where the sun doesn't hide in the winter, where the greens stay green and the crimson canyons still glow. There is a place where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where we drive for show, putt for dough, and settle the score with another round. There is a place.
Trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine, pouring on me. Think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun's gonna shine on me. Sun's gonna shine on me. Sun's gonna shine on me.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that.
Nope, not that.
A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this.
Hello, my track quit.
Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
There is a place where rocks bleed, and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy. Where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents, and opponents are friends. Where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
Where do you find the titans of classical music in St. George? Classical music on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM. Where do you find the legends of jazz? Evenings on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM.
There is a place where young and old make connections, where kids feel like grown-ups, and grown-ups feel like kids. There is a place where beauty arises in contrast, where wonder is universal, and laughter second nature. There is a place where friends find a future, families find each other, and feelings find their home. There is a place.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
Stadium, Dixie State, CSU-Pueblo, locked in an RMAC battle. In week one of the 2019 football season, and Dixie State trailing 20-0 at the halftime break. Dixie State came into this one with high hopes of trying to set the tone early and put this. We were talking earlier, we won't have the official number till later, but this looks like it could be close to a record crowd here inside Trailblazer Stadium. And there's just not been Drayson, a whole lot for this crowd to cheer for.
Yeah, just 56 yards of total offense for the Trailblazers, 39 on the ground on 14 attempts, 17 yards through the air. Compare that to 350 yards for total offense for Pueblo. You know, just three first downs for Dixie State. That's the tell of the tape, as we were talking about, not able to get a consistent drive going downfield. Had one first down and then had to punt, or a three and out, have to punt. That's one of the things we were talking about. Got to get that consistency going in the second half. See if you can't string a couple first downs together. Hopefully you score, and if not, you put a little bit more pressure on the Pueblo defense.
Yeah, I agree with you, Drayson. And another thing, offensively, the run game. Seiji Luongo's had a couple good runs. The zone read hasn't worked. Getting the edge hasn't worked. And there's been a lot of miscues on even the short slant routes and key situations. They only hit that one time to get a first down. The other times they were throwing wide. So they've got to just kind of sync up a little bit better with the quarterback and the receivers.
Dixie State trailing 20-0 at the half. It's the Seven Oaks Jewelers halftime report. We do have a couple of highlights to look at, so let's take a look at those now, and then we'll continue to break down the numbers. And there they are. Dylan Hendrickson getting in, and that was late. That kind of helped change that last drive as he got that sack. But CSU Pueblo set the tone. That was Gunnar Lamphere before he kind of left after being shaken up. That was one of the best read option runs you've ever seen.
Yeah, and that one came out just a few plays after he got that little injury, and maybe just a little stinger.
Of course, Dixie State would hold up for the goal line stand later on that drive and force them to a field goal.
And how awesome was Dixie State, other than this time where they ran it in the red zone when it was a condensed field with 10 yards or less. They did a great job.
Darren Jones had that long kickoff return. You see the end of it there, and Dixie State could not capitalize on that, but this has been the story of the night. The pass game for CSU Pueblo has been on point. We heard him talk about it in camp all during the fall. And the pass game has set up these shorter runs into the end zone. And that is what has helped CSU Pueblo build this lead. And it's like a complete opposite of what CSU Pueblo has been known for throughout Coach Richland's tenure. But, you know, it was all about the run to try and maybe loosen up a pass play for CSU Pueblo. Now, yeah, they're passing first, and then when you try to stop that, then they're throwing their potent running attack into it still, and then almost 400 yards of total offense for CSU Pueblo in the first half.
Last year, I think they had one game the whole season where they threw it for over 300 yards. Most games, they were around 150, and like Drayson pointed out, already at 274 in the first half of this game. And I think the credit is that is they've got two talented quarterbacks and Lamphere and Kitna was awesome in that second quarter.
Yeah, it's one thing to have a lot of wide receivers and ideally want to throw the ball deep, but you can't do that unless you have a capable quarterback, and we've seen just that from Jordan Kitna. Obviously, Gunnar Lamphere exited early with an injury. Not sure if it was an injury or maybe they were just going to Kitna, and then he got the ball rolling and stayed in from there. We're not totally sure on that, but you have seen a lot of times where he's made plays. Yes, he has gotten tackled a few times on some read options and things like that. Hasn't got the ground game maybe necessarily like Gunnar Lamphere has, but we've certainly seen he's got a big arm and he's very accurate throwing down the field, especially when you've got big receivers like Ammon Johnson, Nick Williams. Deontay Sykes has been the main thorn in the Trailblazers' side right here. He's a good deep threat.
We've pointed out a couple of things on this halftime stat sheet. You know, you point out that Dixie State's 1 of 7 on third down. You got to convert on third down. You've got to do better than that. Only 56. I mean, just look at this. This is a Dixie State team that the philosophy is go hard, go fast, right? So, you know, get a lot of plays in, except if you go hard, go fast, right to three and out, you're not going to hold it. Dixie State, 25 plays in the first half. CSU Pueblo, 44. They're not going slow necessarily, but they're making plays and keeping the ball. And then right down below there, possession time. 20 minutes, 22 seconds of possession for CSU Pueblo. 9 minutes, 38 seconds of possession for Dixie State. The Trailblazers have just not had the football. I mean, CSU Pueblo has doubled the possession time, and I know I keep saying I sound like a broken record, but when you go fast, if you can't get first downs consistently, you know, it might be time to go into the locker room and say, okay, maybe we slow it down just a little bit and see what we can do differently. You know, it's tough to run that offense against a good defense. And CSU-Pueblo, that defense is winning that battle right now and keeping the football away from Dixie State. I mean, that's one way to win a football game is keep the hands out of the offense.
And, you know, early they tried to throw it deep a couple times. They missed some guys. They threw that interception. And it's easy to say, well, you got to stretch them out vertically. That's going to open up everything for your offense. But nobody's been open down the field. The defensive backs have been great. They've gotten a little pressure on Willstead, and he hasn't had a ton of time back there. So it's not something you can go into the locker room and script something up or whatever. You're running your offense. The concepts are there. They're just playing great defense. They're right with the receivers.
Yeah, you look defensively for Dixie State. I mean, it all comes back, like you mentioned, to the offense not being able to sustain the drive. But, I mean, you've done well. We talked about Austin Michi and how prominent he was coming into this game. He doesn't even show up on the halftime stat sheet. You got DJ Penick there. Nick Williams had a big run in the first quarter. Then, of course, Jordan Kitten, the quarterback keeper, a couple times has been able to get free and pick up a couple positive yardage gains there. But, honestly, the run game has not really been the thorn in your side, and that was what we were talking about most coming into this game. The Trailblazers have done a good job focusing on that. Now if they can just expand it to stop the perimeter game and the passing game and combine that with what they've done defensively against the run game, should be able to get back into this one.
It's the Seven Oaks Jewelers Halftime Report. We're breaking it all down here. We're going to step away. Let's take a two-minute timeout. We'll come back and give you some thoughts. We'll revisit our quality in keys to the game and kind of grade those out and see how Dixie State can make some adjustments here in the second half. Two-minute timeout and back with the last part of our Seven Oaks Jewelers Halftime Report.
There is a place where the desert comes alive, where rain breaks forth from solid stone and gardens spring from blistered rock. There is a place with enough color to make a rainbow jealous, where boulders are bigger than buildings and cliffs are higher than clouds. There is a place that will straighten your step, tighten your grip, widen your eyes, and open your jaw. There is a place.
Take the road less traveled, run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine. Pouring on me, think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me. Sun's gonna shine on me.
Welcome back to Trailblazers Stadium. Dixie State trailing 20-0. We're inside the Seven Oaks Jewelers Halftime Report. Carrick Sagmiller, Andy Thompson, and Drayson Ball on the call. It's the Jimmy John's Kickoff Classic. Jimmy John's is a proud sponsor of Dixie State Athletics, and they sponsor our Poor Skin Report. So we'll have that coming up here in just a little while, but we're chowing down on some Jimmy John's during the halftime break, and Coach Peterson likely chowing down on some halftime adjustments, trying to see what they can do differently here in the second half. Let's revisit our quality in keys to the game. And if you've got that graphic still on hand back in the truck, let's take a look at that. Keys to the game, let's bring those back up. We talked about winning the battle in the trenches, guys. You talk about it, Dixie State defensive line has been
not
incredible.
Bad, yeah.
A couple different goal line stands, keeping their guy, their team in it. You know, without that, maybe it's two more touchdowns, and maybe you're looking at a 30-plus point deficit right now. So I think defensively, Dixie State getting that done. The offensive line, though, not quite the same, not quite winning those battles in the trenches.
Yeah, they've been unable to run the football. But like you said, I've been impressed. The physicality is about equal. And on the defensive side of the ball, they're not being pushed around at all. That's a huge win so far, I think, for Dixie State.
You talk about execution, sound execution. Dixie State has had a couple of penalties after the play. They've had the one interception. So execution maybe not as high as you would like to have it, something to improve on there. And then lastly, we said you got to make big plays. The only big play to draw on right now is the Darren Jones kickoff return, and the offense wasn't able to do anything with it. So there you go. You get half of a point on the win the battle on the trenches on the defensive side and really limiting the CSU Pueblo run, but then the execution and the big play is just not there for Dixie State. You hope you'll be able to see those in the second half.
Yeah, you've had a few opportunities where you could have moved the ball, got a few more first downs, but passes were thrown wide, led the receiver too far. Obviously, we talked about the interception. You mentioned that. Haven't really been able to get the run game going. That comes back to the offense with the battle in the trenches offensively, and then make big plays. You know, the Pueblo has gotten all, if not most, of their points from just those big plays, those deep pass plays. I can think of, recall three of them that led to points directly, either touchdowns or field goals. That's really been in their favor as well. If you can equalize them in that situation as well and of course, bring along your execution, you should have a chance to get back into this game as well as your defense has been playing.
And I think with the execution, some of those deep passes were made. That pass interference one where the kid catched it anyway, they made some great catches. But other ones, it's just Colorado State Pueblo putting their athlete one-on-one on an island against Dixie State's athlete, and theirs being better, just running right past them. So I think Dixie State defensively has to do something schematically to make it easier on their guys. Maybe that means putting less pressure on Kitna, but umbrellaing the secondary a little bit. You can't allow them in the second half to get those easy throws down the field.
And the thing about it is head coach John Risson is so good that he's able to make those adjustments on the fly. If you are putting, seven defensive backs or even eight defensive backs into the secondary, then he'll just run that read pass
Absolutely.
Option, give it to Kitna, give it to Michi, give it to Pennick, give it to Marcus Lindsay as well, and then he can beat you on the ground game. So it really is a two-man horse here, a two-headed monster, if you will. So the Trailblazers have to be able to man up with seven guys, ideally, maybe if you can even get away with six guys defending in the secondary. That allows you to put pressure on Kitna, limit the run game like they've been doing. And if you can do that, then they really got a good chance to get back into this one.
Well, there you go, revisiting our Quality Inn keys to the game. Quality Inn, one of our fantastic sponsors of Dixie State Athletics. That'll do it for the Seven Oaks Jewelers Halftime Report. We'll keep it right here as the time is winding down. And they'll put 15 minutes up on the third quarter clock. And, guys, CSU Pueblo going to receive the third quarter kickoff. And perhaps that's one reason Coach John Risson wasn't in any hurry to take any real big risks. You don't want anything fluky to happen. Maybe a pick six. I don't know. Now they get the ball back, and they get to try to march down the field here. But Dixie State out on the field to put this one into play. And it'll be Matt Lewis doing the kicking honors as a freshman out of Phoenix, Arizona, Desert Vista High School. And this will be his first collegiate kickoff. Dixie State didn't have any kickoffs in the first half. And he'll put this one into play back deep to receive for the Thunderwolves as DJ Pinnick. And alongside him is Tevin Donnell. Regardless of the score, it's September and we're playing football. Nowhere better to be, right?
Than at
the football field.
Absolutely.
The conference is not won or lost on the first game of the season.
Certainly not. Been a weekend full of Dixie State athletics, and this is just the very last one. There's an 11-match volleyball tournament, four women's soccer matches played here in Trailblazer Stadium, and now this. Filled it by Donnell, 10-yard line, has room to run across the 30, 35, and tripped up just short of the 40-yard line. A good return by Donnell. And CSU Pueblo will start at its own 39-yard line.
Yeah, good return there by Donnell. He was able to get up the middle of the field and avoid a few tacklers. A really good blocking there by his return team. A good field position. They mark him down there at the 37-yard line. But a good return there from Donnell.
K Kitten will jog the troops out onto the field for the first time here in the second half. And they've moved the ball back to the 37-yard line, not the 39. Kitna to Michi, end around left side, cuts it back up left hash across the 40 and tackled across the 40 to the 44-yard line, and a flag after the play. And that may go against Dylan Hendrickson. Is the way the referee ran in and was looking at him, and the guys were trying to separate him after the play. This may be against Dylan Hendrickson and Dixie State. I hope not. I hope I'm wrong. Now Dylan jogging off the field, so very well could have been what it was.
Yeah, it looks like it is against the Trailblazers.
So that'll give Pueblo first down. But you see here, Michi, you see he's very good at cutting the ball up laterally. When he sees that hole, he puts his left foot right into the ground, cuts into that hole immediately. That's what makes him so good as a runner, is he knows where the hole is at and he can get to it as soon as it opens up.
First down and 10 for the Thunderwolves into Dixie State territory. Now they run the same play, end around, and Anthony Yarbrough chases him down from all the way across the field, and Michi loses 5 yards. What a play by the reigning RMAC Freshman Defensive Player of the Year.
Amazing athleticism to chase down a running back from the far side. Tackled him high, but got him down. Huge play.
And Anthony Yarbrough, the reigning RMAC Freshman of the Year. See, he comes from the far side of the formation, just scrapes along that offensive line and grabs Michi there by the head and throws him down.
14:08 remaining here in the third. Kitna, play action. Pressure comes. He escapes. He's at the 45, diving for the original line of scrimmage. And not quite going to get there. And two Trailblazers down in the backfield. Anthony Yarbrough is one of them.
That's Tyler Heaton.
And Tyler Heaton.
Those were the two that put the pressure on Kitna originally to force him to step up into the pocket. Maybe as they were converging to sack Kitna, may have run into each other. Neither one of them really moving around at all. One of them, Yarbrough, is at the 49-yard line, and Heaton's just a few yards behind him at the 45.
Dixie State not able to catch a break on the injury front tonight. Not sure if we have a replay of that. Tyler Heaton with the hands on the helmet. That's never a good sign. So you see Yarbrough come in. Oh, boy. Yarbrough come in. You can kind of see it went out of frame. He went, was going down low as Heaton was going up high and looked like Yarbrough threw the legs, maybe
yeah,
through the knees
it was
of
kind of,
Tyler Heaton.
It was kind of awkward. I was anticipating a collision maybe head-to-head, but it looks like they got tangled up high and low, and they're working on that right leg of Heaton. Mm.
Let's step away. Let's take a 30-second injury timeout and then come right back to Trailblazer Stadium with 13:56 to play in the third. Dixie State having a rough go on the scoreboard and trying to keep guys healthy in this one. 30-second timeout right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
Where do you find the titans of classical music in St. George? Classical music on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM. Where do you find the legends of jazz? Evenings on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM.
Welcome back to Trailblazer Stadium. Guys, originally after seeing that replay, I thought that Ty Heaton might have had the worst end of that, but Yarbrough having some trouble getting off the field even with help. Heaton was able to walk off on his own. Yarbrough is helped off the field by a pair of trainers, and you only hope that, you know, maybe it's not as serious as it could possibly look right now. Our thoughts with Anthony Yarbrough. Hopefully they can figure some things out. On third down and 11, Kitna. Room and time to throw. Pass is overthrown and incomplete. Perhaps Kitna's first, and perhaps you can say this, his first errant throw of the night. Pressure came. He had to get rid of it and threw the outstretched hands of his receiver.
He stepped up in the pocket. That was a touchdown if he threw it to him. The first, like you said, Carrick, first mistake by Kitna. I love the pressure, but they haven't been able to wrap him up and get him down. And just a little wide.
Yeah, good pocket awareness there from Kitna. Just those subtle movements inside the pocket, steps up maybe just a half a step or two, avoids the pressure, gets that ball away.
Punt is away, angling toward the Dixie State sideline, and it'll go out of bounds right around the 15. They'll mark it at the 14, and Dixie State will have an 86-yard field to start this thing. But, hey, you checked the first box. You forced the three and out. You got the ball back with 13:37 to go. We mentioned it during the halftime break. A lot of football still to be played in this second half. And if you can march down, put some points on the board right now, you can get the momentum going back your way.
And I'm anticipating first down throwing, trying to get it into the hands of anybody but Powell, who's been the only guy catching balls for you.
It is Cody Wilstead at quarterback, end around. Darman Natoa.
Good run.
Shakes off one defender, and he'll pick up 5 yards. And it'll be second down and five.
This is what Dixie State has to do in this second half if they're going to want to have a chance to cut into this deficit. You see there, give it to Natoa on the jet sweep. Gets a good block there by number 26 for Dixie State. That's Connor Miller.
They'll hustle up to the line and do it again. Natoa will dive forward for just one more yard. It'll be third down and four, and this is kind of what we were talking about.
Yeah, third down.
Know, during the, it's third down already, and barely 30 seconds have come off the clock.
Doing the opposite of what I thought, but the first run was good. Now they're in a third and gettable here, but they haven't been able to get it so far this game.
Third and four, only one third down conversion so far. 1 for 7, looking for number two. Two receivers split out to the left. Jalen Powell in motion from right to left. Wilstead claps his hands. Pressure comes. Complete to Natoa out of the backfield. Shaking and baking right at the sticks. Where do they mark him? And they're going to give him, it looks like, the first down. Needed 4, got 5. And that wasn't a given after he made the catch. He got some yards after the catch to complete that one.
Yeah, and he was wide open on that outlet route. I don't know if that was designed or if that was his check down, but good awareness by Wilstead.
Dixie State with the first down. Wilstead loads up. Fires across the field to Ricky Johnson. Makes one man miss. The freshman across the 40, diving to the 42-yard line. A pickup of 17 yards on first down. Dixie State moving the chains on back-to-back plays.
The freshman standout from fall camp, Carrick, you and I have talked a lot about this guy. Not a lot of people know about him. Ricky Johnson, the freshman, gets out to the sidelines, cuts back and makes a guy miss. You see there, picks up extra yards and sets the Trailblazers up for their second consecutive first down.
First and 10 from the 42. Leave it with Natoa. Natoa lowers the shoulders and will drive forward for 2 yards, center of the pile. 11:48 to play. Dixie State facing a second and 8, trying to get into CSU-Pueblo territory. Pistol formation with Natoa behind Wilstead in the shotgun. Wilstead stretches it out. Natoa off the right tackle, and he'll pick up 2 more yards, and it'll be third down and 6.
First time we've seen the pistol from this Dixie State offense. You give it to Natoa. He's been their workhorse so far. This down every play going to him, except for the one that went to Johnson. You see here coming off the right guard. Excuse me, the right tackle. That's a deep Jowney leading that hole.
11 minutes even to go here in the third, and here's Wilstead with 2 receivers to the right and 3 to the left, empty backfield. 5 receivers set for Wilstead. Play clock at 5 and 4. Got to snap it with 2, and he gets it. Quickly loads up, fires incomplete. Right at the sticks. It's about a 5-yard throw intended for Darman Natoa out of the backfield. And now a Dixie State offensive lineman is down and injured.
And Cody Wilstead elected to go try to get the first down on this play, but had he pump faked that one and went down to Dantzler, he had a wide open Dantzler. Dantzler's receiver read Cody Wilstead's eyes on that check down kind of out route and committed immediately. Had Wilstead pump faked, brought that defender down, he would have had a long touchdown pass to Dantzler, would have been wide open.
10:44 to go in the third. Dixie State facing a punt situation. And yet another trailblazer being attended to. Out on the field. Let's take another injury timeout. 30-second timeout. Come back to Trailblazer Stadium.
There is a place where looking out means looking in. Where an impression lasting only a few seconds will be imprinted on a life forever. Where courage is forged and innocence rediscovered. Where remembering is rewarding and forgetting unforgettable. There is a place where truth is felt and where seeing is believing. There is a place.
.10:44 to go in the third. Dixie State trailing 20-0, and great shot for you TV and internet viewers of the moon. Just want to brag on our video crew here, CEC TV, and some of the top instructors and leaders there at CEC TV, giving the instruction, and our great students. Everything you see here tonight is student-produced.
But their best work is clearly Urine Drayson's commercials, which I've thoroughly enjoyed. You guys are some of the best. You're right up there with the Mayhem guy for Allstate. You guys are right there.
Hey, yeah, I'll take that as a compliment.
Absolutely.
I like those commercials.
Great chemistry.
And that's a shameless plug now for our Trailblazer Weekly Show every Wednesday at 3 p.m. Tune in and watch as Drayson and I break down the latest in Dixie State Athletics. Dixie State Athletics YouTube page, CEC TV, as well as on the radio. Keaton Mott going to put a foot into this one. And a good punt by Mott will be fielded at the 5-yard line. A flag flies late as Acostaino is tackled at the 15-yard line, and that's right where they're going to put the marker.
Flag came in from the referee. He threw it about midfield. It got to about the 35-yard line, but
picked it up and
brought it back.
Or are they bringing it back?
It's going to go against Pueblo.
You know, you don't realize how much you rely on the ref mic until it's not working.
See if we can see here. Might have been a block in the back, I guess, is what you could call this position. Didn't see much there, but, I mean, break for the Trailblazers. Maybe their first of the game. This one backs up Pueblo deep in their own side of the field. They'll stop to start this drive from the 7-yard line.
10:33 to go. Third quarter, Dixie State trailing 20-0. Carrick Segmiller, Drayson Ball, Andy Thompson with you live on the triple cast. Kitna hands off to Pinnock. Still on his feet, angling to the left side, and is brought down at the line of scrimmage. He went through about three different levels of defenders on that, guys. Bounced off the first, the second, and then the third. Was finally able to come in and bring him down. For no gain.
Yeah, William Payne, the right defensive tackle, was able to get into that one and blow this one up from the get-go. You see him bringing down Pinnock right there.
Second down and 10. 10 minutes to go. Here in the third, Kitna surveying his options. Pocket collapses, steps up and out of it, and he'll pick up 1 yard on the play. It'll be third down and 9.
And a big... big success there for the Trailblazers because he was looking for the deep guy and he had to pump fake and move up into the pocket, which allowed him to be brought down without turning it loose.
And that's what you were talking about, Andy. If you can get some pressure on the quarterback and while you're containing those receivers downfield and not give them time to get those deep passes off, you've seen what the Trailblazers' defensive line has been able to do. That one again, William Payne forcing Kitna out of the pocket.
Interesting to watch Kitten in those situations. He's holding the ball in one hand out in front of him. He's liable to fumble the football. On third down, end around right side, cutting it back up with a hash mark, and he's going to pick up the 9 he needs for the first down.
And I love that. If you're a Dixie State fan, you love that call. They're going to run it on third and 9, and you had them crowd, you just got to make that play. Anytime they don't throw it, that's a win for you, the way you're playing run defense. And they turn him back inside, and there's just nobody there to make the play. Or there is, they just don't make it.
Yeah, Isaiah Diggs just weaving in and out of traffic and able to just kind of find his way there in a few different couple of small juke cuts. Gets the 9 yards necessary to move the chains.
Clock rolling, 8:50 to go in the third. Kitna will leave it with Pinnock. Bounces off one defender, spins the other way, and he'll pick up 4 yards. Second and six.
Trainer's out on the field wanting to talk to
Malachi. Malachi was a little slow to get up. Bruno Silva, we'll give him a shout out on the air. He likes it when we do that. 8:30 remaining in the third and rolling. CSU Pueblo in no hurry with a 20-point lead. Pinnock, free around the left side, 40, 50. Cross the 50 into Dixie State territory to the 46-yard line.
And what are the first kind of traps or counters that we've seen out of the I formation with a single back, had lead blockers, and they overwhelmed that right side of the Dixie State offense this time.
Yeah, and this hole opened up like you could drive a bus through this one. Panic just gets around the edge, gets into space, and he's fast enough that he's able to bring this one for a huge gain. You know, we talked about this a little bit earlier. Pinnock wasn't really known coming into this one. He was listed third on their depth chart behind Michi and Lindsay, but he's played tremendous today.
Pitch out to Michi, right side, stiff arm, and he's brought down just across the 50, and I keep calling him Michi. That's not Michi. That's Marcus Lindsay. You get that jersey scrunched up. You see the two and the short, stocky build. It looks just like Austin Michi.
Yeah, and this is Darius Nash coming down from the safety position. Reads this one well. Fills the hole you see right there. Very good recognizing the hole and brings down Lindsay there from behind, limiting the gain to just one.
7:20 remaining, and Pueblo just content to run, run, run. Kitna. Right as I say that, they throw the pass, and it's incomplete, intended for Ammon Johnson.
Well, but a conservative pass, and they had that one look early where they were throwing it deep. But if you're Dixie State, you're happy. It looks like Riston is content, going a little bit more conservative, running the ball. And if I'm Dixie State, I'm happy with that, even though time is going off the clock.
Crucial third down here for the Trailblazers. Already backed up in your own territory now across the 50. Get a stop here. Get your offense back out on the field. They had some success last time. See if they can get back out on there.
And off, here's Lindsay, bounces off a tackler, breaks another tackle, and he's got a first down. Needed 9 for the first down. He'll pick up 12 yards and first and 10.
Second, third, 9 in this series where they run it, and you have guys all over the running back, and they can't bring it down.
Watch the replay. 1, 2 broken tackles. And it's the third guy that's finally able to get to him from behind, Dylan Hendrickson. First and 10 from the Dixie State 36-yard line.
That's been one consistent thing we've seen so far is when these running backs get into open space, the first guy's not been able to bring him down for Dixie State. That's something you got to change immediately.
Snap to Kitna. Slings it, and it's complete to the big receiver across the 25, diving down toward the 20. And that's
Dejmon O'Neal,
6'4". I think that's shortchanging him a couple inches. He looks taller than that.
Yeah, big guy, 200 pounds. First time we've called his name, but you see here, he's just in the slot, just runs a simple little route, 5 yards maybe is all, but then gets it into space between three Trailblazer defenders, picks up a couple extra yards.
Kitna totally changed his arm angle on that one, throw it a sidewinder. This kid's talented.
Lindsay. Keeping the feet churning, and he will pick up 5 yards, second and 5 across the 20 down to the 17-yard line. I've been impressed with Marcus Lindsay, guys, as he continually is hit in the backfield and continues to bounce off defenders and bring guys along. Lindsay again around the left end. And he's tripped up, picks up the first handed.
I don't know if he got hit or if he just fell. That was a weird play, but trying to tackle him up top hasn't worked. They've been trying to put him in headlocks instead of just going after his legs. This time they lose contain, and then Lindsey just stumbles over his own feet.
I was going to say, I didn't see a red jersey around him when he went down. He's the only one that can tackle himself. 5:28 to play, first and goal for the Thunderwolves from the 10. Read option, Kitna going to keep it this time, and he's going to score. Takes a hard hit, but he's into the end zone. You establish that run game, and then the read option works to perfection.
Yeah, you see the fake was here to Penick, and you know, can't really fault the Trailblazers defenders for falling for this one. They give it to Penick often, and you see here Kitna just keeps it, runs it right up the gut, goes basically untouched there until the last yard or so when he's tackled into the end zone.
Must get that running ability from his mom, because I don't remember John doing that too many times. Go for two there.
And what did I just see? An unsuccessful two-point try with a 26-0 lead.
It looks like they thought they had numbers on. They don't swing the gate back, and Dixie State was prepared for it.
They snapped it sideways. The ball was in the middle of the field. They snapped it to the left hash, had a back there, and just was kind of behind three or four offensive linemen there. They've done that a lot of times, but not been able to do it successfully. I mean, they haven't attempted it. Of course, they do that to see if they have the numbers, and if they do that, then
5:20 to go. Dixie State trailing 26-0. It's the media timeout. 90-second timeout and back.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this. I need a one dance. And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
For over a century, Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life. With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
There is a place where the sun doesn't hide in the winter, where the greens stay green and the crimson canyons still glow. There is a place where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where we drive for show, putt for dough, and settle the score with another round. There is a place.
.520 to play, Dixie State trailing 26-20 after the failed two-point attempt for CSU-Pueblo. Here's Darren Jones. Flag flies, and he's tripped up at the 15, make it the 17-yard line. But typically, where you see that flag, it's going to be some sort of block on the back or a hold. Or
Jones electing to bring this one out, catching it 2 yards deep in the end zone. That'll end up costing him eventually.
Take a look ahead at the Dixie State schedule. Drayson, you and I are getting ready to road trip over to Durango, Colorado next week as Dixie State will take on Fort Lewis. We'll have the call next week. Drayson and I will on the road. And then after it's a three-game road swing. So at Fort Lewis next Saturday, at New Mexico Highlands on the 21st, and at South Dakota Mines on the 28th. But then after that three-game road swing, five of your final seven games of the season are at home. And that is what is coming up on the Dixie State schedule.
And it was indeed a block in the back going against the Trailblazers. They're going to be pinned deep in their own field inside the 10.
On first down, a run right up the middle, and it goes nowhere. Sage Luongo, we haven't seen him since
mid-second quarter.
Second quarter, and he gets a carry here. No gain, second and 10.
You see Keaton Mott back into the game at quarterback for Dixie State after the no gain there from Luongo.
4:45 to play in quarter number three. Mott handles the high snap. We'll sling it to Jalen Powell. Spins around, makes the catch, trying to get the sideline. He's tripped up. Gets the first down. But a shoestring tackle, keeping that from a larger gain.
Good job by Mott, staring down pressure. They sent five. Two guys coming right at his face. And he delivers a strike, but still a really athletic catch.
Play action. Pressure comes. Mott had to just get rid of it. Dixie State trainer in the area, Ryan Willis. Could have made the catch, but then he just let that one go on the sideline.
Officially, the referees say Jalen Powell was in the area to avoid the intentional grounding on that one. But, yeah, Keaton Mott forced to just get rid of that one. Empty set here for Dixie State. We've seen this them go to this a few times. Not a whole lot of success. Obviously going to go through the air here.
Pressure comes. Mott slings it. Sideline gets rid of it.
And it's got to be a frustrating night so far for Casey Allison, DeJuan Danz. They're on the outside. They're getting pressed. It's been a struggle to get off the ball. They have safeties behind them because linebackers are covering your slot receivers. It's just a tough defense to throw against.
Jackson Wibbles and Christian Shaver there forcing the pressure to force Keaton Mott out of the pocket and throw that one away.
Mott will step up. Completes this one. Xavier Smith breaks a tackle. He's got the sideline. Knocked out of bounds at the 50-yard line. You talk about making big plays, and that's Xavier Smith's first target of the night. Breaks a tackle and zips down the sideline to midfield.
And shows off the strong arm. Mott from one hash to another throws a rocket. That had to go a long ways. Turns him towards the sideline, and then the yards after the catch. Great job.
First down, Luongo. Turned into a CSU-Pueblo Oreo cookie there. He was the cream filling in between two white jerseys.
Yeah, James Maxey and Trevor Filio were the two jerseys that sandwiched him up there after no gain.
They're going to give him 1 yard officially, it looks like. Second down and 9, 3:35 to go in the third. Mott claps the hands, fires to the right side. Catch is made by Connor Miller.
Yeah, a little 5 yard out here by Connor Miller. Mott hits his third step on the backdrop and then finds Connor Miller streaking to the outside. Pick up a 5, forces third down and 4 from the 47 yard line.
Third and 4 into Thunderwolf territory at the 47 yard line. Mott to CJ. Around the left end. Voids the tackler to the 40, 35. And down near the 30-yard line, check the field, no flags. Big run for C.J. Luongo. The sticks move, and the Dixie State drive stays alive.
And the contained guy was there. He saw him coming, and Luongo just defeats him going over the top here with a little side swipe stiff arm and gets the first down.
Finally, some consistency from the Dixie State offense, moving the chains here consecutively. See if they can't punch it in and get some points on the board.
2:50 to go in the third. Mott. Going to take a home run ball to the end zone, and it's incomplete. Boy, it looked like Casey Allison was held up there, but the official made no move for his flag, and there was no argument from Allison.
Marcus Lawrence there in coverage. Maybe the only reason I could see referee kept the flag in his pocket was maybe the ball was uncatchable perhaps, but certainly did look like Marcus Lawrence was holding his left shoulder
it's
there.
It's uncatchable, but he's
his right shoulder.
Like they're doing the do-si-do there.
Yeah.
Arms locked. Second down and 10, Mott. Play action, swings it to Devin Osborne. He makes the catch at the line of scrimmage and he'll dive forward for a pickup of 4 yards. Third down and 6, upcoming.
And good block by Powell on the edge. We haven't seen enough of that, I don't think, where you get it out wide, you're struggling to run it between the tackles, give your athlete a chance. Devin's first catch of the game, and he does at least a little bit with it to make it a third down that you can get.
Trailblazers spreading the ball here. Xavier Smith, Devin Osborne, first targets and catches on this drive.
Play action. Mott will throw it up to the 6'7" receiver, and it's incomplete. Devin Osborne was the target. Incomplete, and it'll be fourth down.
And the back judge there, the referee back there, just under the goalpost, saying over his head, uncatchable. That's why there was no pass interference call on that play as well.
Does he not realize Devin Osborne is 6'7"? I guess it's fallen.
I thought Mott could have waited a little longer. He threw it off his back foot. He could have let that play develop just a beat or two more.
Dixie State going to go for it on fourth and six. You need a touchdown on this drive to stay in this thing. Mott will step up. Fires across the middle. Tipped up and incomplete. Flag flies. Finally. Connor Miller looked like he was held up.
I think you're going to get Kyle Rosenbrock here, who was in coverage with Connor Miller coming over the middle. I think he may have just got there a little bit too early.
I was told that some work was done on the referee mic, and they're going to try to give this thing another go. So we'll see if we can't get that as soon as they're done deliberating. You'd hate to see him pick this flag up. Been that kind of night for Dixie State, though. A couple early opportunities to have big fumbles and big game momentum, game-changing momentum swinging plays go their way that were ruled not fumbles.
Referee's still deliberating. Not sure what there is to talk about. I mean, other than if the one referee had a different angle and saw that he'd got there first, or maybe the ball got there before the hit came. You know, not sure on a pass play like this, when a potential pass interference, what it could be.
Pass interference.
Hey.
Number 8 of the defense. Spot foul. First down.
There you go.
It's Anthony Barron. I misspoke. Thought it was Kyle Rosenbrock, but it's Anthony Barron. You'll see here on the replay as Keaton Mott steps up into the pocket. Pueblo defenders all around him. You see there, Barron just grabs the backside of the jersey.
That throw was probably the most uncatchable of any of the last three throws. Keaton Mott will load up to the end zone. Jalen Powell there makes the catch. Touchdown, Trailblazers.
And we've seen Mott throw in direct lines and on his RPOs and stuff like that. That was a beautiful touch pass. Allow your athlete, Powell, to just run underneath it. Gets his feet in right before the sideline.
Jalen sets up in the flat here, runs a little what's called a jerko route. You fake your defender in, and then you run to the corner, make him look like a jerk, as they say. This one was lofted up beautifully by Mott and floats it right up there under Jalen Powell. He runs underneath it and scores a touchdown.
First time this season we get to see James Baird out on the field. The kicker that came from Snow College with Coach Peterson. Connor Miller doing the holding. Baird will split the uprights, and Dixie State on the board, 26-7, 1:54 to go in the third. Hold your horses, we're not done yet. 60-second timeout and back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
Run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine. Pouring on me, think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me. Sun's gonna shine on me.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this.
I need a one dance.
And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
1:54 remaining in the third. It's a 19-yard strike from Keaton Mott to Jalen Powell to cap a 12-play, 92-yard drive, guys, in just 3 minutes and 20 seconds. And they're going to do a short kick. It's fielded at the 20. Bumped at the 25. It's Pinnock, and he'll dive forward. Where do they mark him? Did the knee go down? across the 30 to the 32-yard line.
And the good news for Dixie State, you just scored your first touchdown of the game. The bad news is the last time the Thunderwolves had the ball, they probably had their most balanced series, both running the ball and throwing it, and went down and scored to extend their lead. Can't just gear up against the run, even this late in the game. They're still throwing it down the field with Kitna.
Trailblazers defense got to get back to what they were doing earlier in the game in the first quarter, limited the Thunderwolves to just 3 points in that first quarter, see if they can get a little momentum after the score.
I think you've got to force a turnover. Kitna up under center, fakes the pitch, and then slings it to the near side. Catch is made, and receiver going center of the field. Escapes all of the tacklers across the 50. He's free inside the 30, and diving near the 20-yard line is the receiver, Deontay Sykes. And he's not sure how I feel about the stare down of an injured player after the play, but a good play before that.
He hasn't gotten a lot of touches in the second half. This is an easy one. He catches the screen pass and then just does something special here. Totally reverses field, gets some cutback blocks, and his speed does the rest.
Yeah, Deontay Sykes has really been the key for the Thunderwolves offense. He's had a couple of big plays downfield. That one created by himself. That one balling traveled 2 or 3 yards downfield. He had to cut all the way back, goes from the right of the formation all the way to the left. Of course, gets a couple of key blocks to get big yardage.
Clock rolling, 1:33. He'll pitch to the right side. And upended by Alex Lilliard is Austin Michi. We haven't seen a whole ton of Michi tonight. And even though he's probably going to be the starter in almost every game, I think he's going to play the role that he's been playing the last 3 years at CSU-Pueblo. Come in, take a run every now and again, but I think you're going to see those other guys be the feature backs for this program. Back to Michi. Starts around the left, cuts it back in at the hash. And after losing a yard on first down, we'll pick up 7 on second down. It'll be third down and 6.
Saw this play earlier for Michi, kind of a little counter play, if you will. He lines up on the right side, but comes back to the left across the formation. Gets out to where he knows the hole is, puts his left foot on the ground, and cuts up the middle. This one not as successful as the one before, but does pick up 5 yards to force 3rd and 6.
Clock rolling, 30 seconds to go. Play clock at 15. Got to run at least one more play. Michi, delayed handoff, and he'll dive forward. He goes nowhere. In fact, loses a yard. And that should end the third quarter. Ball right now is at the 18-yard line. Check that, make it the 19-yard line.
Michi lost a yard on that
one. Yeah. So right now on fourth down, you're looking at about a 36-yard field goal attempt for CSU Pueblo. After 3 quarters of play, CSU Pueblo leading 26-7. And Pueblo, the entire team is doing kind of a dance over there. Looks like Remember the Titans-esque. Dixie State trailing 26-7. Can they try to turn this thing into a comeback opportunity? We'll find out. We'll take a 30-second timeout, just a 30. Come right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
There is a place where rocks bleed and nature blushes on a battlefield green with envy. Where dimples determine destiny, and a tiny wooden tee holds the outcome in the balance. There is a place where friends are opponents, and opponents are friends. Where the prize is elusive, the conquest is captivating, and the score isn't settled till the drinks are down. There is a place.
Fifteen minutes on the fourth quarter clock, and indeed Mitchell Carter on to try the 36-yard field goal left hash. It is up and good. It looked like a Dixie State player got a deflection on it, but it still finds its way through as the Dixie State band played through that entire play.
Yeah, this one just long enough to creep over the crossbar. You see there, good distance on it, just enough to get it in there and splits the uprights.
14:55 to go, CSU Pueblo 29, Dixie State 7. Trailblazers hold them to a field goal. Take a 60-second timeout. Come right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
Where do you find the titans of classical music in St. George? Classical music on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM. Where do you find the legends of jazz? Evenings on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM.
There is a place where young and old make connections. Where kids feel like grown-ups. And grown-ups feel like kids. There is a place where beauty arises in contrast. Where wonder is universal. And laughter, second nature. There is a place where friends find a future. Families find each other. And feelings find their home. There is a place.
.455 to go. Dixie State trailing at 29-7. After the CSU-Pueblo 36-yard field goal. Thunderwolves will get set to kick this one back. DeJuan Dantzler is back there. And Darman Atoa is also back deep to receive for the Trailblazers. And Natoa gonna take a fair catch just inside the 10. Smart play. Dixie State will get it at the 25.
Saw the best drive of the game, no doubt about it, after the touchdown on the previous possession for Dixie State. They were able to get a lot of consistency both on the run game and through the air. Keaton Mott did a very good job of finding the open receivers, and then those receivers also did a good job of getting some extra yards after the catch. See if they can continue that momentum and get back into this game.
After leading the field, leading the team down the field for a touchdown, Keaton Mott will remain as quarterback. He'll have three receivers split out to the left. One receiver near side is Casey Allison. And the running back is Andrew Canelli Robles. At his right hip. He'll give to Andrew, and he's hit immediately. No gain, second down and 10.
If there's any sign of good news, at least for Dixie State's defense, Anthony Yarbrough is up and moving around, running some jogs, some sprints back and forth on the sideline. Looks like he's feeling a little bit better after getting shaken up earlier in the game.
And never what you want to see at any point in the season, especially in the first game of the year. Keaton Mott going to hook up with Jalen Powell for a 6-yard gain toward the far sideline.
Tevin Donald.
Are they going to say incomplete?
Oh, wow.
Are they going to say he did not have his feet in bounds?
Hard to see from that angle. Yeah, an all or nothing play from Tevin Donald. Tried to come up and undercut that ball and pick it off. If he does, it's a pick six, but incomplete.
Third down and 10. 14:20 remaining. Here in the fourth, Mott. Pressure coming. Rolls out to his right. Throws downfield. Catch is made.
Wow.
Are they going to say he's in or out? Chase Hess, the tight end, transferring down from Snow College. Still no call. They're going to say he's out of bounds. And Coach Peterson can't believe it.
One of Mott's best throws on the move. Throws a dime right on the sideline. Hess with an incredible effort to pin his toes on the sideline.
Should have a good replay review. You've got a couple of cameras down on that sideline to see if one of them caught it. We'll get a good look here. As you see, Mott rolls out to his right, forced out for some pressure from the defensive line. You see him rolling, waiting for Chase. Throws it to his back shoulder. I don't know about that one.
You can't. The camera moves over too fast. You couldn't. His feet may have been off the ground.
His feet were below his hands. His feet have to come down first in that situation.
Heck of a catch by Chase Hess as the Keaton Mott punt is fielded on the bounce. And the return across the 50 One man to beat, and Keaton Mock goes down and makes the tackle. And the returner can't believe it. He thought he had a touchdown. And Isaiah Diggs is tackled by the quarterback, Keaton Mott.
And how many times has that happened tonight where Dixie State just barely misses
a big play
and the next play is just a huge one for the Thunder Wolves?
And you see here, Diggs fields it off the bounds, starts to the right sidelines, cuts it up, and then just gets out in space. And he's so fast. He was able to get almost like a sprinter there. Once he got going, he was hard to catch. And then, of course, Keaton Mott there undercuts his legs and chops him down to prevent the touchdown.
And now a real short field for CSU Pueblo starting at the Dixie State 24-yard line. Give to Lindsey, and he surges through the entire defense for a 9-yard pickup.
And he's been awesome this second half for the Thunder Wolves. I don't know how many broken tackles, but they have a chance at him right around after 3 yards gain, and they just are grabbing at him. And no shot.
Yeah, and give him credit. I mean, he keeps his legs moving. He doesn't go down easily. He's like a stick of butter. You know, he's always trying to move, and he's just tough to wrap up and bring down.
Right back to Lindsey. And he'll pick up the first down on his own. CSU Pueblo player is not happy after the handoff. Dixie State defensive lineman Mitch Jacobs, it looks like, knocked Kitna to the ground. You can't see it in the frame there, but the flag flew, and I think he's going to get flagged for it. He had an offensive lineman.
It's one of these
Pueblo
things
trying to follow.
Kitna's got his back turned to the end. He's handing it off. The end's assuming that he didn't give it, and he's got to tackle him, at least from that perspective.
Maybe that's what the referees are discussing at this point. The back judge, it was the referee.
I mean, the RPO is such a huge thing in the game nowadays. I mean, how do you make a player just completely give up on a play?
And with Mitch Jacob, he's coming from that left side. He can't see whether the ball has been given to Lindsey or not.
Personal foul, number 44, defense, half the distance to the goal. After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct. Number 79 offense, 15-yard penalty, first down.
So those penalties should offset then, right? And they're going to bring the ball back.
Well, one of them went half the distance to the goal. The other one was a 15-yard variety.
Well,
I think the
result
there
of the play will
nullify
will hold
itself.
Up. Yeah.
But I think the difference there was one was during the play, one was a dead ball penalty. That's why they don't necessarily offset. The result of the play is going to be the ball is going to be spotted at the 20, which is a little bit back from the original line of scrimmage was previously, so that's the distinction there.
Rules analyst, Drayson Ball.
That's what they pay me for.
Are you getting paid for this? I'm not. 13:20 to go, Dixie State.
Well, if you're not getting paid for this, then I certainly am not getting paid for this.
I guess it's in my salary.
We know Andy's buying dinner because he's the one that's getting paid the big bucks to do this one as well. So,
got $4 each at Subway after the game, boys.
Subway's not even open after the game. That's pretty safe.
We'll go on the Sabbath.
Well, I mean, Subway's not even open. Is what I'm saying.
Oh, I see. I'm saying we'll go tomorrow.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
All right. A little lunchy.
Yeah.
I think the referee's still trying to figure this one out. I'm not sure. I mean, what there is to discuss.
But the result of the play was a first down either way. Lindsey ran for a first down.
I think they thought they had it all settled, and now the lines judge comes in and is still deliberating. I mean, at this point, let's just put the ball down and play football.
It's been a long weekend. A lot of Dixie State sports here. 11-match volleyball tournament Dixie State hosted this weekend. And also had 3 other women's soccer teams in, 4 matches in a couple of days as well, and capped off with a football game. Lindsey is brought down from behind by DJ Heckard.
And I've been impressed with Dixie State on those pitches. They've done a good job filling backside, and the contain man's done awesome. And aside from, I think, one time, the Thunderwolves haven't been able to get a lot on those.
Yeah, and this is what the Thunderwolves were doing earlier in the game that they had a little bit of a success on, is running these jet sweeps or these kind of plays to the sideline. That one sniffed out and tackled for a loss of one.
Handoff on first down, Lindsay. Yeah. Again and again tackled by Heckard.
And that's just dragging people on that one.
And as mentioned earlier, Anthony Arbo back in the game now. A good sign for Dixie State. You see here, you get the pressure off the end there, but he's able to cut it inside, makes a couple guys miss, and then he just drags one of the Dixie State defenders with him. That's Braxton Hatch that brought him for 2 or 3 yards extra.
Flag flies. It's a free play for Pueblo. Throw to the end zone, and it's going to be...
I think the receiver stepped out of bounds and then came back in.
Yeah, that's why the referee's not wearing his hat.
Of course, it was a free play. That would have counted had it been completed.
Yeah, it was offsides against Dixie State, free play. But anytime you see the referee throw his hat, he's marking where a player went out of bounds.
Rules analyst, Carrick Segmiller, everybody.
I just get that from watching games on TV.
Offsides, number 96, defense, 5-yard penalty, first down. The receiver went out of bounds on his own, touched the pass, incomplete pass, first down.
Of course, can't be the first player to touch the ball after going out of bounds by yourself. If you're forced out, that's a different story. But you see here, he steps out right there,
comes
back in. He does get both feet down. He only need one in college, but having stepped out of bounds, can't be the first player to touch the ball after coming back in.
After the offsides penalty, first and goal from the 7. And Lindsay again on the run.
Tariq right there up the middle. That's one of the first times we've seen Lindsay be brought down upon initial contact. You see right here, gets a good push, wraps him up. That's what you got to do. You got to wrap him up and not let him get past you. Get full feet there and brings him down after a gain of just 1.
CSU Pueblo taking its time. Clock rolling, 11:20 to play. Second and goal from the 7. Kitna, Tamichi. We'll get down inside the 5, down to the 4. And a pickup of 3. Give CSU Pueblo third and goal from the 4.
If there's one thing to be encouraged by for this Dixie State defense, in addition to the other things we've talked about earlier, is how they've performed in these red zone situations with their backs against the goal line. You see here, forcing another third down and goal. We've seen them have a number of goal line stands here, forcing a couple of field goal attempts. See if they're able to do it here on a critical third down play.
And a poor snap. The ball is loose.
That was incredibly close. Three defensive linemen sprinting onto the field. The line judge went to his flag, didn't pull it. They got back apparently just in time, did Hendrickson.
In the meantime, was that a direct snap to Michi, or was it a pitch out?
It was hard to see. The ball hit the deck. Michi just had to fall on
it. Okay, so it was a pitch.
It just was a pitch.
He wasn't expecting the ball yet.
Yeah, Kitna just threw it immediately. I think what he was thinking is if they could get it out there with those defensive linemen coming onto the field late, they would have had numbers. Michi wasn't expecting it at that point. The ball hit the deck. Austin just had to fall on it. It'll force a fourth down. They're going to go for it.
They're going to go for it on a fourth down and goal from the 11 in a 29-7 ball game in the fourth quarter. And Kitna is sacked. Dixie State defense says, you're going to try to run the score up on us, we're going to take you down.
And it was Alex Lilliard getting pressure up the middle. You see forced Kitna to step up into the pocket. Good coverage downfield, and Lilliard pulls back and grabs Kitna from the backside.
And that takes us to our media timeout. 9:50 remaining in the fourth. Dixie State trailing 29-7. 90-second timeout and back.
Dixie State University has been shaping the trailblazers of tomorrow by providing a culture of active learning, active life.
With a paradigm of real-world experience mixed with cutting-edge technologies and rich traditions, we provide one of the most affordable educations in the West set against the most stunning backdrop on the planet.
There is a place where the desert comes alive, where rain breaks forth from solid stone and gardens spring from blistered rock. There is a place with enough color to make a rainbow jealous, where boulders are bigger than buildings and cliffs are higher than clouds. There is a place that will straighten your step, tighten your grip, widen your eyes, and open your jaw. There is a place.
Take the road less traveled, run free, unwind, unravel. Someplace outside with lots to do. Green trees, red rocks, and don't forget that blue sky. The sunshine shining, fun shine, pouring on me. Think I might just stay a while. Say hooray all day because the sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me. Sun is gonna shine on me.
9:50 to play after the media timeout. Dixie State trailing 29-7. First and 10 at its own 13 after forcing the turnover on downs on the sack. And on first down, Mott feeling the pressure. Spins out of a tackle and throws it away. And then is brought down after the throw.
Pueblo defenders asking for an intentional grounding. That one, he was inside the tackle box. The referees are conferring right now. This one was thrown away. He was inside the tackle box. How are they going to say there was a receiver in the area?
I don't see a flag.
The ball went past the line of scrimmage. Second down.
Didn't get the first half of his call there. But
the ball went past the line of scrimmage, so on second down, pressure comes again. Mott gets out of it, completes a pass to Dewan Dantzler across the 40, down near the 45-yard line. And after absolutely racking up the receiving yards the last two games of last season, Dewan Dantzler makes his first catch of the season.
And the first play we've seen where it was kind of an improvisation, that wasn't the initial route. He peeled off his route and got open in a gap there. Big play by Mott.
Mott fires slant route. Complete to Jalen Powell. The ball comes out. And Dixie State players are all acting like they have the football. They do.
They do.
It was Mott who got it.
Mott got down the field and recovered the fumble.
It's interesting. See, I thought this one might have been ruled down initially. We'll see.
Nice.
Ah, that one's pretty close. I mean, that one's just as close as the other one that wasn't called a
pretty simultaneous.
Mott flies out of
gotta
nowhere.
You
gotta love that. But again, going back to that, it looked to me like the knee was down. Yeah. You know, that's easily as close to the one back from the first quarter that wasn't called.
Yeah, for sure.
Just about the same type of play there.
Mott loads up, fires near sideline, incomplete, intended for Ricky Johnson.
Thought he had Connor Miller maybe more open than Johnson. He was committed to that sideline route.
Marcus Lawrence playing good coverage, forced this pass to go high and up. A good location from Keaton Mott where only his guy could get it. Thrown a little bit too tall, though.
9:05 remaining in the fourth. Dixie State trailing 29-7. Two receivers split out to either side. Low snap. Mott handles it. And is stripped from behind as he tries to throw and recovered by CSU Pueblo. Or no, they're going to say it's an incomplete pass. The arm was moving forward. Finally, Dixie State gets a break on one of those types of calls.
And I think this was the right call. You see the low snap here. You see Jackson Wibbles coming from the right side. Excuse me, that's not Jackson Wibbles. That is Trevor Filio.
I think that's fumble, boys.
His arm was going forward, but it was after he had been in contact and the ball was knocked.
Bang, bang play for the referee.
Yeah.
Though hard to make
we'll
the distinction.
We'll take it. We're not going to complain about it.
Hard
absolutely
to make the distinction there
we'll
in that situation.
It.
Trailblazers.
That's the first time tonight one of those calls has gone Dixie State's way. 29-7. Dixie State trailing on fourth down. Mott rolls out to his right, fires, one-hand catch, Jalen Powell! Right at the sticks, or was he short? He might have been 1 yard short of the first down.
Tremendous athleticism from Jalen Powell. Keaton Mott rolls the pocket out to his right. Powell comes back, grabs it with his left hand, tiptoeing the sidelines, maybe steps out, I guess, just a step or two before the sticks. Tough to see from that angle. Would love to see another replay, see if we can get that camera down.
Officials, timeout for a measurement.
Well, where have they spotted the football? Because I see refs standing all over the place.
The yard to gain is the 47-yard line. It's going to be right there close. We'll see where they spot it, though. We got one umpire near side of the field. They haven't put the ball down
maybe
yet.
It's down. You just can't see it because we're looking through it.
It's going to be on the near side all the way across the field. The official sticks are on the far side. Get a good look here. See if we can see from this different camera angle where he actually steps out. It's going to be tough.
Right there, but you can't see what yard line that is. And, of course, now we just – oh, here we go.
I think we missed
the measurement watching that replay.
I think it's going to be a turnover on downs.
But Dixie State defense is coming out on the field. But what a catch by Jalen Powell.
Paul Peterson being very vocal on the sideline. Not sure he loves that spot there after a tremendous catch by Jalen Powell as the Trailblazers turn over on downs.
It's just been kind of that kind of night. Something good happens, and then, not quite. Kitna, pump fake. Is hit from behind. Ball is loose, and does Dixie State have it? CSU Pueblo wanting to argue the same thing. Hey, I'm throwing the football.
No signal yet from the referees. They're conferring right now. Dixie State, everyone's pointing that way.
There's been a lot of discussion in this game.
The pass complete. Quarterback's arm went forward. Second down.
I think it's the right call. He threw the football.
Yeah, I think that's the right call.
8:47 to go. And off to Pinnock, and he evades a bunch of defenders, and there he goes, 30, 20. Can Darius Nash stop him? He's brought down inside the 10, down to the 5-yard line. It's kind of interesting, this CSU Pueblo attack, because they've almost completely abandoned the pass game. Not completely, but the entire first half was all pass, 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 and they've gone back to their bread and butter here in the second half.
Good vision there to see that hole. He actually just split between two Pueblo offensive linemen to hit the hole and then, of course, got out in open space, and his legs did the rest.
End around. Runner is stopped, and now you're going to come back the other way. Cuts it back up the middle, and it's brought down at the 10-yard line. He'll lose 4 yards.
So Isaiah Diggs do this on a couple of drives ago. You see he gets the end around there, but pressure forces him to cut backfield. He gets running backwards at one point. You see right there going in the opposite direction, and good job of the Trailblazers to stay in their locations and keep contained there to bring him down well behind the line of scrimmage.
Dixie State player shaken up after the play, Darius Nash.
And how awesome has, one of the rare bright spots Dixie State's defense been from about the 15-yard line in. You saw a great job on that play of both sides, keeping the edge strong and making the tackle. Brings up a second down. From the 9 and goal.
I think Diggs tried to do, if I remember correctly, Diggs tried to do that exact same thing before, and this time, no,
yeah.
Trailblazers stepped it out pretty well.
8:07 remaining. CSU Pueblo, second down and goal from the 9. And Kitna keeps it and is smothered.
Yeah, that was Anthony Yarbrough back making his impact known again after being out a short time due to an injury. He just wraps him up there, gets some help from his buddy, Lenandre Schwally. Down behind the line of scrimmage, forces a third down and long here, goal to go from about the 11-yard line.
7:25 to go here in the fourth. Kitna up under center. Takes a few steps to his left, fires back to the left, and is it intercepted? No! That's Ty Hill who's got it. And the referees say no, incomplete, and Ty Hill not happy. And if that name sounds familiar, the younger brother of
Trevor Hill. Yeah, right.
Dixie State basketball, great.
Oh, I don't know about that one. That looked like he had his hand underneath it. May have hit the ground initially. It's hard to tell from that angle, but that one looks pretty good. A bang-bang call, though, for the referee.
A good look from our CEC TV crew. And now, once again, with a 3-touchdown lead, CSU Pueblo keeping the offense on the field and going for it on fourth and goal. Unbelievable. Kitna lobs to the end zone. Incomplete, but flags fly. Question is, did the tug come before the throw, or was it after the ball is in the air already? Holding before the throw.
Automatic first down.
Yeah, distinction there. Holding, as you mentioned, can only be called before the pass is thrown. Pass interference, of course, once the pass is released, if you interfere with the wide receiver. But you see here, that's on the top of your screen, just out of view. Darren Jones there gets the holding call. Pass intended for Dijmon O'Neal.
I guess call me crazy. I just don't know why it's necessary to go for it on fourth down in field goal territory when you're up 3 scores. Kitna will leave it with Pinnock, and he's in. Touchdown. And the trend continues, Andy, as you pointed out earlier, is every time that it looks like Dixie State might have a big play, call doesn't quite go their way, and then a couple plays later, touchdown.
Yeah, Dixie State has missed. We've talked about it, whether it's penalties or near misses on first downs, fumbles
so interceptions.
Many, so many different things that have, you know, the majority of them haven't gone their way.
I'm halfway expecting a fake here. No, they're actually going to kick it. And it's up and in. 36-7. CSU Pueblo leading it midway through the fourth. Take a 60-second timeout. Come right back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
Where do you find the titans of classical music in St. George? Classical music on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM. Where do you find the legends of jazz? Evenings on Radio St. George, 100.3 FM.
Na, 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 na. Are we there yet?
Yep. We're here.
It's a short drive from your neighborhood to your naturehood. To find a neighborhood park or green space near you, visit discovertheforest.org.
Back in play, short kickoff, and it gets past Dixie State. Dwan Dantzler able to pick it up. He's across the 20, and then yanked out of bounds at the 25-yard line. And with 6:57 remaining, Dixie State will send the offense back out on the field.
Looks like it'll still be Mott. Well, I think he's played pretty good these last few series.
Yeah.
They haven't been able to convert, but I think he's looked good running around out of the pocket, making athletic plays.
And a couple of passes, you know, the one here to the sidelines, Chase Hess, that was ruled out of bounds. Jalen Powell caught that one-hander that didn't get quite to the sticks. Those couple of plays go your way. You know, you never know. But like you said, Andy, Keaton Mott has looked good. Just a few things haven't quite gone his way yet.
Snap to Mott. Finds Connor Miller. 3 yard gain, second down at 7.
A little out route by Connor Miller. He's a good, reliable receiver there from the slot. Picks up 3 yards. Get off to a good start for this series for Dixie State.
Mott gives to Sejay. And that play is blown up.
I think you got to throw that play out of your playbook for the rest of this game. One, because I know they're not going to come back, but just you need to prove your pass game right now. And in this situation, it's a great opportunity, and the run game hasn't been working at all anyway.
Yeah, Trevor Filio has been in Dixie State's backfield a lot. And this one, he blows this one up and holds C.J. Luongo up just enough to wait for his teammates to come and bring him down well short of the line of scrimmage.
Mott on third down, stepping up, flings it ahead to Casey Allison. And what a way for Casey to make his first catch of the night on a broken play.
Trevor Filio comes in untouched on kind of a stunt. Luongo tried to cut him, but.
CSU Pueblo player down after the play. Dixie State trailing it in the 2019 home opener. Let's take a 30-second injury timeout. Come back on the Trailblazer Football Network.
So we have to be responsible ourselves for our minds.
True, right? We
can't palm it off on being unwitting dupes and just say, oh, well, it doesn't count because I got played.
Well, we have some unwitting dupes, Jennifer.
We do, but you can't say because we got played by the Russians that we have to redo the election.
Welcome back to Trailblazer Stadium. Injured player is Trevor Filio. You've been calling his name over and over, and he seems to be walking under his own power, which is a good sign. 5:47 to play. We've officially hit the 3-hour mark of this football game. And Dixie State lined up to punt. Keaton Mott doing it all tonight. Tackling, passing, punting. Recovering fumbles.
Yeah.
The Swiss Army knife tonight. Diggs will field the punt at the 30. Makes a couple of guys miss, trying to get the corner. And he's brought down just shy of midfield, the CSU Pueblo player. Down at the 35-yard line.
Good return from my Isaiah Diggs. You know who he reminds me of? 5'6", a little back there. He reminds me a lot of Darren Sproles, played for the Chargers, the Eagles, amongst others. Kind of just a little small guy, hard to see on the football field, but has very quick legs and is able to, you know, cut really quickly and go from one direction to the other at just the snap of a finger. So he's done really well, whether it be returning punts or, you know, in the offensive run game. He's done a lot of things for the Pueblo offense.
Players still down. It's been a tough night tonight. I mean, it's hot. You've mentioned it a couple times, Drayson. I mean, it's super hot out there. Tough night on the opening weekend of Division II college football. We've seen a lot of injuries on both sides. Still 92 degrees outside here in St. George, Utah at 10 o'clock.
Yeah, sun's been down for that heat just sinks into the field and then rises up.
Yep. Player is helped off and will continue play here. And CSU Pueblo going to bring in a new quarterback, Tanner Draper. No. What number is that quarterback wearing?
It looked like 18 to me,
right?
Yeah.
And that says it's a senior defensive back.
Or maybe it's 16. Yeah, I think it's 16.
Zach Cozzolino. That would make a lot more sense. 3 yard gain on the run. Clock rolling, 5:05 to go. Well, we'll have a lot to talk about on our Trailblazer Weekly Show on Wednesday, Drayson. Cozzolino. Delayed handoff. That's a back we haven't seen. Nick Bingham, sophomore running back from El Paso, Texas. And they continue to churn out the yards.
Not a lot of fall off. I mean, from one running back to the other, you know, if it's not Michi, then it's Lindsey. And if it's not Lindsey, then it's Pennick. And, you know, they have just a conveyor belt of good, not only running backs, but a lot of good wide receivers we've seen them spread the ball too as well. I mean, give credit to Coach John Riston. I mean, he knows what he's doing. He knows how to coach. He knows how to recruit, and that's why he's established a good program that's won 7 out of the last RMAC championships.
Cozzolino.
And I think the element that we've seen tonight, and I know it's the first game and we're going to extrapolate a lot out of it that maybe we shouldn't, but the element of throwing the ball that Pueblo's shown tonight puts them, I mean, they're ninth in the country, but it puts them, you know,
in
the stratosphere of being able to compete at, you know, at very elite levels.
Yeah, that's what they've run up against the last couple of years in the playoffs is you get these teams that are super good against the run and they're not able to generate offense because of it. But, I mean, this team tonight, it looks like a playoff football team and a team that could make some noise. First down, Bingham up the middle again, 3:15 to go. There's got to be times as a football coach when you're down 36-7 late in the game. You almost wish you could just hit the – I mean, I'm not saying you're waving white flags, but the more plays that go on at this point in the game, there's more risk for injury.
Right.
And I guess why you switch guys out too, but –
you've been out there for 3+ hours at this point, in
the heat, you know,
heat, it's mostly like, for most of the game, 100 degrees, if not 95 or above.
I mean, at this rate, you're only looking at, you know, maybe 4 or 5 more plays. But Bingham again. No gain, 3rd and 4.
First down for Pueblo here would just about ice it. If they get this the 5 yards necessary to move the chains, they could just kneel on it to run this clock out. Now, whether they'll do that or not.
They'll probably go for it on fourth down.
Yet to be seen. I guess we'll find out here and after this play.
Cozzolino leaves it with Bingham. And he is stacked up and then thrown down after the play, and it's going to be a flag. Mitch Jacobs, and that's his second, and now another flag. Exactly what I said just a few minutes ago, right? I was talking about injuries, but it applies to stuff like that too.
play would have resulted in a fourth down. He didn't have enough yardage to gain the 29 yard line to pick up the first down.
You throw him down after the play. That's a clear cut flag. But I've had an issue with these type of plays for a long time. As we're going to hear the penalty.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 44 of the defense. Personal foul, number 82, offense. Penalties offset, fourth down.
It's still fourth down. I've had an issue with these types of plays for a long time because offensively, it seems like every once in a while you get that ball running and they let that play go forever and then you let 350-pound offensive linemen come and push your guy, even sometimes lift your guy off the field.
And the running
for
back's
10,
not
15 yards, and you let it go on forever. But then when you get four defenders around the guy, you blow the whistle in a heartbeat rather than letting them bring the guy to the ground. And so maybe I'm not a football purist, and I don't study the rules that closely, but I don't see a lot of difference in the two. And being them on fourth down, see, they went for it on fourth down, and they pick it up. And that should just about do it. 1:25 to go.
Of course, clock stops when you get a first down, and once the change is set, he'll wind the clock.
If I was coaching after all these fourth down attempts and conversions, I might still use all three of my timeouts in this situation.
Of course, now we see the Pueblo lining up in what's called the victory formation. Should just kneel on this one two times, and it'll be over.
9 seconds on the play clock, taking it 7, 6, 5, 4, and now you'll see the snap and the kneel. With 54 seconds left, they'll have to kneel on it one more time. In a football game tonight, dominated by the visitors. There were high hopes for this offense, the debut of head coach Paul Peterson and his staff up against a juggernaut in CSU Pueblo. And that'll do it. Dixie State will fall 36-7. And fall to 0-1. On the season. They'll be back at it next week in Durango, Colorado. But guys, quick hitter thoughts before we go to break and then kind of dive into the meat of it.
Well, the downside of playing the best team in the conference your first game is you come into the season with your balloon and totally inflated full of hope, and then you lose a 36-7 game. The challenge now for Coach Peterson, who's had a very positive locker room, he's a very positive guy, is to keep some air in that balloon going into the next game, and that's not going to be a problem. These guys have a lot of confidence, a lot of hope. They played well, I thought, defensively tonight, and they've just got to keep their heads up and go in with full force next week.
We saw some flashes from that drive where they scored the touchdown. They were able to move the ball efficiently, obviously, on that drive. Throughout the game, though, they weren't able to maintain that consistency either before or after that touchdown drive. But we have seen a little bit of Paul Peterson's offense, and if that is that one scoring drive, that is that able to extrapolate over the season, we could be in good hands. But just really good credit to the Pueblo defense. They were really able to limit the Trailblazers offensively, and that they were never really able to get into a rhythm, and I think that's really what caused some disruptions with Dixie State's offense.
Dixie State falls 36-7. Handshake line still going. Always good to see the guys, put the battle aside afterward and shake hands and say, look, we're all doing the same thing. At the end of the day, we're trying to beat the snot out of each other out there on the field. But, it's just a sport. And at the end of the day, we're all playing college athletics, which a lot of people can't say. Dixie State falls 36-7. We're going to take a quick 60-second timeout. When we come back, we'll break it down during the Jimmy John's postgame report. Back after 60 seconds.
There is a place where looking out
means looking in, where an impression lasting only a few seconds will be imprinted on a life forever, where courage is forged and innocence rediscovered, where remembering is rewarding and forgetting unforgettable. There is a place where truth is felt and where seeing is believing. There is a place.
Radio Dixie 91.3. We don't play that. Nope, not that. A big fat no there. That's what we play. And stuff like that. On St. George's only alternative, Radio Dixie 91.3. Oh, and from 9 till midnight, we play this. I need a one dance. And this. Radio Dixie 91.3 FM.
Welcome back inside one final time. Dixie State falling 36-7. Guys, sometimes it's tough to come back and really want to dig too deep into it because there's not too many different things we can say now that we could have said at halftime. But we did see some good things in the second half, and so we welcome you inside the Jimmy Johns postgame report, and we break it down. A team that we knew coming in, CSU-Pueblo, was the cream of the crop. You know, I mean, the question was, you know, are they really, you know, ninth in the country? How much of that is just last year's poll? But, you know, head coach John Richton has you know, Drayson compared it to a conveyor belt. I mean, I'm gonna go another step and just say, you know, he's got an assembly line of you know, they're just building great team after great team after great team, and it's been incredible to see what they've been able to do in a 10-year span. And they're the cream of the crop, and they are every bit deserving of that number 9 ranking. Now, did it mean that Dixie State did not have their chances in this game? They did. They and every once in a while, the breaks just don't go your way. I mean, what if? And you hate to play the what if game. What if the play early in that game is ruled a fumble and Darius Nass runs it in for a touchdown? You know what? What if things like that? And just some of the breaks didn't go Dixie State's way. They struggled to move the ball in the first half. They did move the ball on the one drive, and we saw some flashes of brilliance. We saw one hand grab by Jalen Powell. We saw Chase Hess, the tight end, make a great catch. Saw, you know, a couple flashes from the running backs and a few other things. But, you know, all in all, you're running against a really good football team, and I think that's kind of where you draw the line and say, you know what, that's the first game of the season.
That's
we got
right.
10 more games to go. We can still accomplish our goals.
Yeah.
And let's make it happen.
Absolutely. And I think, you know, like I was saying before, you're playing the toughest team in the league. It's your first game. You don't want to just draw out all the negatives. And I'm sure Coach Peterson is going to just say, flush this one. Let's move on. He was just very animated in dealing with team down. They're all huddled up. He's a positive guy. They're going to find some positives to go with. Obviously, a lot of changes to be made. You know, defensively over the last couple of years, nobody could throw on these guys. And tonight, it was open season for a Colorado State Pueblo team who we don't know how good this team is. I mean, Kitna might be the best quarterback they've had in a while in a system in its second year where they're going to be throwing for 320, 50 yards every game in the league this year. Who the heck knows? But like I was saying, I think Coach Peterson is going to stay positive and keep these guys focused in the locker room.
And I think a few of those positive things that Coach Peterson can spin, you only turned the ball over once. I think that was early in the first half.
And it wasn't a bad turnover.
And it wasn't a bad turnover. It was a deep ball that the defensive back just made a good play on. I think your defensive line played really well at times. Late in that fourth quarter, I think the line was tired by that point, and they gave up a few big runs. But up to that point, I think they had really limited the run game. You look at this and you say, hey, we had a game plan to not let Michi beat us, to not let Lindsay beat us. And for the most part, that's what they did. They forced Pueblo to beat them through the air, and Pueblo, give them credit, stepped up to the task and did just that. They had a few big plays there down the field, especially earlier in the first half, and that really propelled them to get out to an early lead. But if you're the Trailblazers, you came in with a game plan of stopping the run and trying to play good at the line of scrimmage. I think they did just that. Those are some of the few positives. Maybe you get one or two of those turnovers to go your way. It is a different ball game, but a lot of positives to go off of this loss.
Take a look at some of the final numbers as they come in here. Dixie State finishes with 210 yards of total offense on 56 plays. CSU Pueblo, 579 yards of total offense on 87 plays.
Good heavens.
And the total time of possession, 40 minutes, 17 seconds for CSU Pueblo, 19 minutes, 43 seconds for Dixie State. And I think that's something that, you know, you have a game plan, you have a system that you want to run, but I think Coach Peterson will have to look at it and decide, hey, are we giving the ball up too quickly? Of course, every week you're not going to be playing CSU Pueblo's defense. So, you know, in the coming weeks, you could go out and you could see that offense work brilliantly and maybe see a box score kind of flipped like this. But tonight, you know, it certainly was quick three and out after quick three and out after quick three and out, and your defense spent 40 minutes on the football field tonight, and it's really tough to win a game when your defense is on the field that long.
And coming off a season where CSU Pueblo last year only averaged just over 30 minutes of time of possession. So, I mean, they were basically splitting the time between offense and defense. This is a huge swing if you can get an extra 10 minutes on the field for your offense. And as I mentioned earlier, late in that fourth quarter, those defensive players were just gassed by that point, and that's where a few of the big runs came. But if you really look back to the first three quarters, that's where your defense played pretty well with the exception of a few big plays.
And the silver lining is, I think, a little bit, you lost worse to this team last year, arguably, in the first game, and then you went on to have seven wins in your best season in the D2 era. The difference was, you know, Mike Sanders came in, and he was unbelievable last year, but I still think that they believe in Mott and Willstead. Their ability is apparent. They were just kind of, you know, out of sync, I think, and it was just kind of growing pains in that first new system, a bunch of new guys you're throwing to and a new quarterbacks. That's always going to be a challenge.
Some RMAC scores from around the conference tonight. Colorado Mesa 37-33 over South Dakota Mines. Colorado School of Mines 41-10 over Adams State. Chadron State 48-31 over Black Hills State. And Western State falling to Idaho State earlier in the week, 38-13. Apparently, word coming in, a football game, the Fort Lewis game, Dixie State's opponent next week. In fact, their next two opponents, Fort Lewis at New Mexico Highlands game, was canceled. Not sure what for, but like I said, that's the next two opponents for Dixie State, and we'll see. Due to inclement weather, it says. I mean, there must have been some really bad weather.
Yeah, seriously, New Mexico.
Must have been lightning.
Fort Lewis football team was canceled due to heavy rain and lightning in the area. That it just was not going to be able to finish that football game. So anyway, that's Dixie State's next two opponents, and that'll be kind of an interesting that they did play a little bit. The game was called with Fort Lewis leading at 7-0, 6:19 remaining in the second quarter at the time of the cancellation. So if you're Coach Peterson, how do you prepare for football game next week when you only have 15 minutes of game film to watch?
If you're Fort Lewis, when does this game get made up? Are they going to try to play it
tomorrow? I have no idea.
Or is there a bye week? How are they going to make this game up? I mean, you got to play this game, right? It's an RMAC game. It's a conference game. I mean, if they play it tomorrow, it's going to be an advantage for Dixie State because Fort Lewis gets one day off fewer. But I've never seen something like this before. When do you make this game up? It's not like baseball where you get to come back in, you know, 3 months later and you can just play a doubleheader. That's not exactly what you do here in football.
Yeah, there's no information in the article on Fort Lewis's website about when it will be when or if it'll be made up, but I'm just thinking in terms of, and that's why it's even a thing right now, in terms of preparing for a football game. And Coach Peterson probably has enough things right now that they can work on for themselves rather than the game plan for next week and the opponent. But it'll just be interesting to go, and you know, I guess they'll have an entire quarter that they can watch and try and get ready for that football game. But that's the next two opponents, Fort Lewis and New Mexico Highlands. Guys, we got to hand out some awards. I know it's kind of hard to do that on a night like tonight. Our SkyWest Airlines player of the game, as well as our Honolulu Grill play of the game. Let's go with player of the game first as we pull up some of the individual stats in this game. And, you know, it may come defensively for Dixie State as we look and see Alex Lilliard, 11 tackles, 8 solo stops, was fighting off.
He was incredible.
Little injury after little injury.
Yeah, a couple different times.
You know, so he has 11 tackles. Malaki Malaki with 8 tackles. I mean, offensively, you look at it, Keaton Mott, 10 of 21, 112 yards and a touchdown. Jalen Powell had 8 catches for 65 yards and the one score. It was a great catch in the end zone, including a one-handed catch. Luongo, leading rusher, 10 carries, 29 yards. Tough night on the ground. Help me out, guys. Where do we go with something like this on a night like tonight?
I think it's got to be Powell, but I'm thinking defensively for sure. They carried the load for him tonight, even though, you know, they scored up in the 30s.
Maybe you just give it to the defensive line.
Yeah, seriously.
That's what I was going to say. Give it to the defensive line. Good job by Anthony Yarbrough. Tariq Wright was in a lot of plays and caused some havoc as well. I think, you know, we had a couple plays, and if we might jump forward a little bit, play of the game, I'm going to give it to that first goal line stand that they had earlier in the game to force that first field goal. That defensive line really was the most consistent element of this entire Dixie State team throughout the game. So I'm going to give my suggestion for player of the game to that entire defensive line.
I think I can concur with that. Our SkyWest Airline players of the game, Dixie State defensive line, a couple of goal line stands, keeping Dixie State in it early, and then just spent way too much time on the field late in that game. Honolulu the Grill, you know, play of the game. I guess, you know, we can almost go just double time, but I guess you're going to nail it down to one play, maybe the one-hand catch.
Maybe the first down. The best play may have happened on the Chase Hess catch that wasn't actually called a catch.
I mean, that wasn't a catch.
It was a tremendous throw by Keaton Mott and an even better catch by Chase Hess. Fortunately, you know, wasn't deemed in bounds at the time of the catch, but tremendous play. Let's just go ahead and give it to Jalen Powell with the one-hander that did actually count.
A lot of great individual efforts tonight that didn't end up being, you know, quite. You know, you had the Chase Hess catch. Jalen Powell makes the catch, and then he stopped 6 inches short.
The interception.
On the first down, the Ty Hill interception attempt.
It wasn't counted as
well. Man, I'm telling you, there was a lot of stuff tonight that, you know, if this play, but, you know, woulda, coulda, shouldas, or I guess not what you want to think about your football game. But Dixie State falls 36-7. That will do it for us tonight. We want to thank our entire CECTV crew for helping us out. They put in a lot of hours this week along with us with all the volleyball and the soccer and now the football, and they're tired and they're ready to get home. So we're going to wrap things up. We want to thank Rustin for hanging out with us at the 97.7 FM studio, getting us on the air, keeping us on the air all night long. Thank all of you for watching and listening. Dixie State will be back at home. It will be a couple of weeks before this Dixie State football team is at home. Next 3 weeks on the road, and the next home football game for Dixie State will be against Black Hill State on October 5th at 1 p.m. This was the only 7 o'clock game of September. We'll have one more against Simon Fraser on October 12th in the non-conference game. Dixie State will play at 7. But on the road next week, Drayson and I will have the call from Durango, Colorado, and we'll see if Dixie State can bounce back. For the entire CECTV crew and for Rustin, back in the ESPN 97.7 FM studio, Carrick, Drayson, Andy, signing off from the broadcast booth at Trailblazer Stadium. We'll catch you next week.